The Hagmann and Hagmann Report for today. It's Monday. It's a manic Monday, actually. Manic Monday. It's July 21st, 2014. This is a live broadcast. I'm Doug Hagmann, co-host along with my son, Joe Hagmann. Together, we are the Hagmann and Hagmann Report. Folks, we've got a very interesting lineup, a very interesting program, very interesting setup for you tonight. You know, ladies and gentlemen, that we have started a weekend edition, and that joins the weekend vigilante, Sheila Zielinski, with us every Saturday from 8 to 11 p.m. Eastern. Well, tonight we have a very special offering for you. By the way, folks, in case you didn't catch last Saturday's weekend edition, it's archived, and I've got to tell you, it was marvelous. We had the guerrilla economist and the guerrilla spy, followed by Tom Horn. Sheila took the point on the interviews, and I've got to tell you, it was perhaps one of the most free, nicely flowing, and eloquent broadcasts that we've had in quite a long time. Sheila Ken writes for The Examiner, and RogueMoney.com. Before we get into that, I'd just like to remind everyone that, of course, you're listening to the only show where the news is presented to you in 3D. Folks, we look well beyond the headlines, the bylines, the fog of disinformation and misinformation, and right now misdirection, as we are entering into or standing amid this target-rich media headline environment. Every time you turn around, you're running into some sort of dire headline, and people are just wondering where to look. Well, we're going to help you out with that this evening. For the new listeners, I want to welcome the new listeners that have checked in with us over the weekend. Well, they actually span from California up into British Columbia, to Alaska, all the way to Taiwan, United States, Central, South America, and all across the world. Welcome to this edition and hopefully future editions of the Hagmann and Hagmann Report. With me in studio is Joe Hagmann. Joe? Oh, by the way, Joe Hagmann is my son, a fellow investigator, and the co-host of this program. Joe, welcome.
Glad to be here. Yeah, it was a great weekend show, Saturday show. And last night, you and me were on with Brother Marcus on his show on Pine Ridge Warriors, and that was a lot of fun, too. But, yeah, we do have Ken and Sheila with us now. I'm going to turn it over to Sheila, and let's get into the interview.
Yes, well, thank you for that, Joe. And, Doug, I had an email that, just real quick, that something was fading out. I don't know if that was on their end or whatever, but I just wanted to, again, remind people that tonight we're going to bring on in Ken Shorgen. He's, of course, if people didn't catch that, an economist and a finance writer. Of course, he contributes to RogueMoney.net. He's a very incredibly prolific financial writer, also for the Daily Economist, and just has a really good thumb in the pulse of what's going on in terms of everything, all the way around politically, financially, socially, you know, so he's got a really good handle on what's going on. And so I want to invite him to, I want to invite him in, and welcome to the program, Ken.
Evening, Sheila, and evening, everyone.
Well, Ken, it's really interesting that you're coming on tonight, because you've been writing some pretty scathing articles. Let's say they're definitely, you know, they're out there in terms of really pushing the envelope. And again, you're just an incredibly prolific writer, incredible, insightful person who really does have, I would say, probably one of the best financial writers out there. Obviously, if you're writing for RogueMoney.net, of course, V, everyone knows V, the Girl Economist. But earlier this week, I found it really interesting. You wrote and posted an article called U.S. Accuses Russian Rebels of Taking Down Aircraft Despite No Proof. And in the article, you sought not to try to figure out who did it or what happened or what went wrong, but instead I thought you asked a more poignant and important question. It was this: who benefits the most from the taking down of a civilian airliner over Ukrainian airspace. So we're going to get into that. We're going to get into a lot of other things. And we're also going to open up the phones wide open tonight, folks, too, for people to ask him questions or just in general, you know, try to stay on point, but in general, try to keep the focus on what's actually going on right now. And, of course, as everybody knows, we had Tom Horn talking about blood on the altar, which was the war on Christianity. It's basically Christians versus Christians. And I just got inundated with so many people that are actually finding this happening already. So that's kind of an interesting thing. I would love people's comments on also the show for Saturday night. So, again, Ken, welcome, and talk about this. I mean, who does benefit the most from the taking down of a civilian airliner over the Ukrainian airspace, really?
You know, actually, that question, for anybody who's actually paying attention to what's going on and has seen what the United States has done over the past year, year and a half, the answer is quite obviously the United States gets the most out of it. To start off, when the airliner went down, you know, at first I didn't really want to write on it because, you know, I was thinking, what does this have to do with economics? This has to do with a civil war going on in the Ukraine. Then as I started flipping through and seeing a lot of the articles out on the web, out on television, all the pundits were coming on, I'm like, wait a second. This reminds me of the chemical warfare or the chemical attack in Syria, where the United States, at the very beginning, before there was any proof at all, started making, walking that fine line of insinuating that, in that case, Syria, but in this case, Russia, was responsible for this, without actually coming out and making accusations. Though we do know John Kerry sort of made some faux pas when he didn't realize he was on camera, but, you know, that's John Kerry. So I started asking, why are they doing a full pitch effort to blame Russia? So then I went back and I said, oh, wow, look at all the things that happened this week. Started off, we're going to have to go back a couple weeks, to when the Department of Justice decided to fine and indict, do charges and sanctions against BNP Paribas, the French bank. So I started looking into that, and supposedly the sanctions were, or the fine was for sanctions where BNP Paribas was breaking economic sanctions back from 2002 to 2009 in the Sudan, something extremely innocuous, plus the fact that we're talking 5 years after the fact. So, okay, this means that the U.S. Department of Justice is doing this as a revenge factor, pure and simple. So I started looking into it. Wait a second. France is selling two naval gunboats to Russia, and the U.S. doesn't want them to. So this is a way to get at them. And interestingly enough, after the DOJ issued the fine and Paribas decided, you know, we're not going to fight it, we'll just pay for it, the French finance minister came out and said, you know what, it's about time that we started getting rid of a singular global currency and start working on a more balanced system with multiple currencies that are weighed about against each other. It was an underhanded shot at the dollar, and you know what, we're going to start looking more at Russia, India, the BRICS, because they're not going to impose sanctions on us for what we choose to do in a sovereign country. Why is the United States doing it? They're using the dollar still as an economic blunt instrument on whoever doesn't follow its own agenda and policy. So that was the first thing. So then I started going back and I said, okay, what happened next? Well, we had the BRICS Bank. The BRICS Summit was on July 14th. And, of course, there had been talk about this for the last year, year and a half. V has mentioned it many times, Jim Willey. But they finalized the agreement on July 14th. And on July 15th, they came out and they financed it with $100 billion. Now, the significance of the BRICS Bank is that it's the infrastructure that's going to go head-to-head with the IMF and the World Bank. It's also going to eventually be the structure that goes head-to-head with the Swiss system and the BIS, so that countries who want to do trade no longer have to go through SWIFT, buy dollars, come back, buy whatever. It's going to allow, you know, it's going to make trade much more cost effective between countries. Plus the fact that if nations, sovereign nations, need to borrow money from the BRICS, they're not going to be hit with these draconian austerity moves that the U.S.-backed IMF always imposes on places like Argentina, et cetera, where your economy and your society are going to be in bondage for a dozen years. So we had that going on. The third thing that was happened was Germany. Germany made some interesting remarks because Merkel is finally finally ticked off with the CIA and the NSA spying and tapping all their phones and hearing every conversation. So they decided that they were going to, starting from this date, no longer purchase U.S. tech. We're talking Microsoft, IBM, Cisco, none of it. None of their computers are going to have that. None of their hardware is going to be it going forward, which is going to be a huge hit to U.S. trade. Plus the fact that Germany has already been leaning towards Russia because they do more business with Russia than they do with the United States. So we started seeing these dominoes pick up that the U.S. was losing, and the dollar, the strength of the dollar was suddenly getting hit and chipped, you know. Somebody was taking that chisel and just chipping it apart. Then, of course, we have where the CIA covertly and illegally kidnapped the son of a high-ranking Russian minister to lay out false charges of cyber fraud in an attempt, of course, the assumption is he's going to be traded. They want to trade him for Edward Snowden. So with all this going on, the U.S. was losing in the economic game this entire week. The BRIC, you know, the U.S. had to do something to get the BRICS bank and the BRICS infrastructure off of the front page, at least the business page. So it bears a question. Out of nowhere, we have this takedown of a civilian aircraft that should not have been flying over a war zone because for at least 3 weeks, no commercial flights were flying over airspace in Ukraine. So why was this one diverted from its original course from southerly below the Ukraine to suddenly be going directly across the Ukraine? That's why I had to ask the question, because it does not benefit Russia at all to become a pariah to either the BRICS nations or to the world that they're shooting around these type of aircraft.
Very interesting.
Well, you mentioned,
Sheila, I got to say that when I read Ken's article on RogueMoney.net and just heard him speak just now, you know, from an investigative point of view, and we look at everything in that regard. The biggest question is who benefits, and in the end. You know, we also have to look at all of the things that are taking place in the world, not just, for example, not just the downing of the aircraft, but everything else that's taking place, and weigh in the balance everything. And Ken has done just a marvelous job. Ken, I got to tell you, I'd send you an honorary badge from our investigative agency, should you, you know, if you would accept it, because I think you're a phenomenal investigator on this case.
Oh, well, thank you. And I stumbled across that, you know, the Rogue Money article I think you're referring to. I stumbled across some information regarding, because, you know, whenever an aircraft like this gets shot down, you're going to have people talking about, you know, TW-800, which was on the anniversary date. And I started remembering, wait a second. Didn't we have an airliner shot down over the Soviet Union 30 years ago? Of course, I was 16 years old. So it was, you know, in Missoula, Montana, back when I was there. It's not really, I wasn't paying attention. So, but I stumbled across somebody who said, you know what? There was a book that came out in 95 from somebody who was inside the Reagan administration at that time, and the U.S. government had recorded the entire flight path, the information, and they got the recordings from the Russian pilot, Soviet pilot, the Soviet Air Command, and the fact that the Korean airliner, KEL 007, never responded. And I had to wonder, you know what, the Soviet pilot was trying time and time again, so I'm questioning whether that airliner was jammed. Because, of course, we know now that a thorn in the side of the New World Order was killed on that aircraft, Larry McDonald.
That's so very true.
This killed two birds with one stone for the United States, because what it did was it allowed them to go to the UN, vilify the Soviet Union so bad during its last decade before the fall, and it solidified in the American people that, hey, you know what, they are the evil empire. Well, now we go 30 years later. There's a big problem. The big problem is that more Americans watch RT than they watch MSN and CNN. So they're going to get a more balanced look at what's going on, and they're not as easily programmed and propagandized. So when this came out, and Putin, who has been the one calling for peace in Ukraine, not President Obama, it's been Putin who's been calling peace. He hasn't gone inside. He hasn't done anything. People are sitting there going, now, wait a second. Why would Russia suddenly do this if they've been calling for the peace table? And it's the U.S. has not been doing it. So if the biggest thing here is that Russia, China, the BRICS, and their associates are in the process of going full bore to create the new financial system. The U.S. is based on the petrodollar. Once we lose access to the petrodollar and there's enough critical mass out in the world that they reject the dollar, then the U.S. game is over. I mean, it's the Roman Empire who has devalued its currency so bad, nobody will accept it.
I've got a couple people that are texting me here. So you mentioned the word draconian. I think the really key point that you just brought up is July 14th, folks, what Ken's saying is that Brazil met with Putin to finalize that BRICS. I mean, we're talking about vetted associates, but without the whole austerity as far as the Western banking cabal goes and their whole MO, you know, because what's their modus operandi, as you just mentioned, Ken, it's and this whole thing, like you said, it's eerily similar to 30 years ago. But here's the piece I think is the sort of the part that I like. You're talking about a much bigger incident, and you're likening it to sort of the pulling away of a Jenga piece and the eventual collapse of the Soviet Union, and you're talking about that flight 007, correct, over the remote part of Russia's Siberian frontier. And, I mean, as you likened in this article, anybody that's over the age of 40 is going to remember that event. But here's the piece, is the book you're referring to actually really gets into the propaganda tool against the American people. And I think that's the biggest piece right here, isn't it?
Exactly. You know, when a nation and a media go full bore at propaganda, and I want to use the example of the chemical gas attack in Syria. I mean, we're talking Obama, Biden, Kerry, everybody was full bore making accusations without proof and evidence, and they were doing it 24/7. And then Russia was sitting there going, wait a second, let's do an investigation. And Russia went in there, and Russia made sure they got the UN in there. And once they discovered that the chemical weapons were not from Bashir, but were probably from, get this, U.S.-funded, al-Qaeda, Benghazi-armed al-Qaeda, from those guys, the media shut up in a second, and you've never heard anything since then. No response, nothing. Once the jig was up, and they found out that, ooh, maybe the U.S. Had a bigger part in this than the Syrian president or Russia, boom, you never hear it in the media. This is the same thing that's happening. And I don't know if you all saw this evening, Russia has been holding off the UN and Europe from coming in for an investigation over the weekend, for the past 3 days. They've been using that time to try to do their own investigation so that they could have the facts down before the Western-led, you know, investigators come in and totally cover up what was done. Well, Russia had a press conference. They showed a number of things. They have images of Ukraine deploying the BUK rockets from their position on the very same day that that airliner was taken down, they moved it to the eastern border where the rebels are, i.e., close enough to shoot down the plane so that it would crash within the with where the rebels are, not in a different part of the Ukraine. Ukraine moved, or a Ukrainian fighter jet was found on radar, tracking and monitoring and following MH17, the Malaysian airliner. Then, of course, we have the fact that the Malaysian airliner, nobody knows yet why it was diverted from a southerly route over directly over the entirety of Ukraine. And then, of course, we have the fact that Russia discovered that a U.S. satellite was positioned directly over MH17 at the time it went down. This is what they've been doing the last 3 days. So when the investigators come in, Russia's already got their ducks in a row, so they're going to sit there and go, okay, let's see what your information is to correlate with ours. You can't do a cover-up and leave us holding the bag. This is not 1980-whatever. This is 2014, and we've got technology too, and we're going to make sure that our side of the story is put out first.
Yeah, and ladies and gentlemen, if I can just say this, ladies and gentlemen, the reason why we have Ken on today along with Sheila is they have done such a fantastic job individually and cooperatively to look at the real facts. You know, you're not going to be able to turn on Fox News. You're not going to be able to turn on anywhere that I've seen, and that includes the alternative media, and get this specific information. When Sheila was talking to Joe and I about the information that her and Ken were talking about, we felt it incumbent upon us to get this information out there, because I'm going to tell you something, folks. This is the stuff that starts or could start a global conflict. This stuff could start World War III. This is a propaganda windfall, in the words of in Ken's words. And folks, look, you've got to take this very seriously. And in this case, we cannot overstate, and we're certainly not understating the case. So this is pay very close attention, ladies and gentlemen, to what is being said here, because this is balanced truth. Sheila, I didn't mean to interrupt. Go ahead.
Well, I just think he's taught, you know, I mean, I think this is very integral to exactly what you're saying. Let's springboard back to the mainstream news telling us that the Soviet Union would willfully and purposely shoot down that Kel 007 because their empire was a brutal, and of course it was an ideological authority that, you know, surely was secrecy at all costs. Talk about the revelations uncovered by Alvin Snyder and then the director of the U.S. Information Agency's television and film division, please, Ken.
Yeah, that was interesting because Alvin Snyder, then director of the U.S. Information Agency film division, wrote his book 10 years after the fact. But from the information they found, he found right off that the press was given leave to manipulate the government findings. And this was under the Reagan administration. You know, so those who think that everything was hunky-dory, there was always an agenda to bring down the Soviet Union, and that was the feather in their cap. In the case of what happened, here's the interesting thing. Soviet fighter jet shot down KAL, Korean Airline 007, back in September of 1983. It had strayed hundreds of miles off course and penetrated into the Soviet Union's most sensitive airspace over military facilities in Kamchatka and Sakhalin Island. The important part of this, and this is where another parallel comes into play. Prior to KAL 007 coming over Soviet airspace, the Soviet jets had rushed out, had sent out a sortie because 2 hours before, a U.S. spy plane had crossed over into Soviet airspace, and then they chased it back and it went back on U.S. side. So there was already one incident of the U.S. sending one of its military aircraft into Soviet airspace that day. When KAL 007 came over and the Soviet jets were launched to flag it, they tried to hail and contact the pilots of this jet, but there was no response. Over and over, there was no response. That tells me more than one thing, that their communications were jammed. Because the Soviet Union really did not want to do this, and who would it benefit in that case? As opposed to now, it would benefit the U.S. again. I guess in both cases, it would benefit the U.S. Now, what was found is that recordings that the U.S. got from their spy planes between the Soviet fighter pilot and air traffic control was they were horrified that they had done this. They purposely thought that it was a spy plane coming for some nefarious mission. And when they found out it was a civilian aircraft, they were flabbergasted. They did not want to do this. So with that mistake, the problem was is that the deed was done, and the Soviet Union, being such a secret society without the technology we have today, the propaganda war was very simple for the U.S. They could say anything and everything they wanted because the Soviet Union, with their agenda of secrecy, how could you really come out, because they weren't going to provide any evidence to the contrary.
But Ken, how does the Soviet How does a Soviet fighter jet stray hundreds of miles off course and, you know, penetrate some of the Soviet Union's most sensitive airspace over their military facilities? That's the part that I've never wrapped my head around.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering about, KAL, because, you know, it's the same thing with, well, you know, you have to wonder, too. I can't say that I know that the GPS, you know, what was it? They didn't have GPS per se back then, but they did have something, I think, GNSS, which was the precursor to GPS.
Right.
And what was told was, or what I read, was after the KAL incident, the United States military opened up GNSS to everyone to ensure that something like this did not happen again. So that was the advent that led to that. And so could you manipulate?
Yeah, well, let's fast forward to this week, though. I mean, how do you, you know, you have this Malaysian flight 777. It was shot down over Ukraine. And to date, it is a mystery who fired upon the aircraft. And I think more importantly, or what forced the airliner to go off course as well. I mean, we're seeing a strong correlation that Malaysian flight also entered into restricted airspace. It was restricted for several weeks due to the ongoing civil war. I mean, so I guess, you know, you're seeing some strong parallels. And from the moment that airliner was shot down, propaganda went into full Mach speed on steroids, did it not?
That is correct. And from what I've gathered, it's not restricted by the Ukrainians. It was considered an off-limits by the commercial airline. You know, sort of like a warning, you know, enter at your own risk. And so a lot of airlines were diverting to different flight paths. But at least as far as I've seen, the Ukrainians did not restrict the airspace, only that commercial airlines and different countries said, you know, gave a warning, this is off-limits airspace, got to find other flight paths. And like I said, from what I've gathered, they were supposed to be a southerly route below through the Black Sea, more towards Turkey than you know, Ukraine. And somebody somewhere probably told the pilot, hey, you know, you can't fly there. You got to cut across Ukraine. It's going to be okay. This is what I'm gathering is it probably from air traffic to the pilot rather than a manipulation of electronic gear. Because here's why. What was the first thing that the Ukrainian government did on July 18th? They rushed in and they took all the tower logs and the tower recordings.
Yeah.
So nobody knows exactly what was said and who said it.
I guess it does little to answer the question of why that flight was off course, but I guess the point, whether it should have been in that airspace or not, why does the U.S., why is it that the mainstream media, especially particularly in the U.S., so eager to just pin the blame on Russia without any due diligence or proper investigation or backup, any facts or assertions? You know, it's crickets chirping on that, but of course, you know, it's absolute, yep, Russia did it, we know for sure. I mean, it's only been 72 hours.
Why? Because the United States, and especially the CIA, which controls media, understand psychology. People will believe the first thing they hear. even if evidence comes out later and the facts come out later, they still are bound by the first story they hear. And if you saturate them for the first 3 days on a certain storyline, eventually when it comes to truth, let me give you an example in the business world. When first quarter GDP came out, first quarter GDP was, I believe it was 1.1% negative. Okay, the markets reacted to that. Okay, fine, boom, boom. They've had two revisions since. It's now negative 2.9%. The markets did nothing on that day when the new revision came out. A negative 3% economy is like deep recessionary, and they just blew it off because people react to the first piece of news that they hear, and if they hear it in saturation form, then it solidifies, and that's the story they believe no matter what. And that's what that's what they're trying to do. Same thing with the chemical weapons. You know, if you ask a lot of people in the U.S. today, hey, we've got evidence and proof that it was the Al-Qaeda rebels who in Syria who used the chemical weapons, they're going to look at you conspiracy theorists. Why would they do that? They have no reason. You know, they make excuses just knee-jerk because they've already built in their mind the paradigm of what they want to believe. This is the same thing here. Is the saturation of the media. Those who watch mainstream media don't really watch it to get the news. They watch it because it's a celebrity popularity contest. You know, everybody looks nice. Everybody's, and the way the NLP that's done on those shows, it's ripe for people believing. So that's the point about all that.
Well, I think when it leads to the root of the question of your article, I mean, the bottom line is who would benefit most by the downing of a civilian aircraft? And again, I think the, you know, if it was internationally diverted to fly over a war-torn country, despite warnings that one or both sides had anti-aircraft capabilities, I mean, does it really, is this really the MO of Putin? My gut tells me no. What do you say, Ken?
No, Putin wouldn't do this. Putin has too much to lose. You know what he's trying to do? He's trying to win the propaganda war for Europe. He's trying to say, look, we're not the Soviet Union. We're not the evil empire that the U.S. tries to portray us as. We are creating an economic partnership where everybody is welcome following the same functions in a new, eventual, gold-backed trade settlement and a gold-backed currency down the road, which will bring back sound money, which will stop this whole morass of dollars and derivatives and yada. Oh, you know, this is what they're offering. Why would they do something like this? Why? Because they have too much to lose. Now, there is always the potential that the Russian separatists shot this down by accident. And from what I've been seeing on social media, I can't verify it, but I have seen the story on social media. Just like in 1983 when there was a U.S. spy plane that had crossed over 2 hours before the Korean airliner came by, someone said that the Russian separatists had shot down a Ukrainian transport earlier that day. So if they shot this down, if they did, they probably thought it was another Ukrainian aircraft because they knew that it was a no-fly zone. So why would they even believe that there would be a commercial aircraft coming over?
Well, and I think you touched on something earlier that I think people have to try to wrap their head around, too, and why this is so important is, let's face it, the American empire, the big juggernaut, is in the twilight of its golden reign. You know, it's got a currency and a debt problem, you know, placing it upon the, as V says, it's the last drunk at the punch bowl. You know, it's on the precipice of a collapse and hyperinflation. And, I guess the only power right now is control over the petrodollar, and it's a highly powerful military juggernaut as well. But really, reliance on those two things, let's face it, things are looking pretty bleak. So I think it's just very interesting. If people really step back and take a macro view here, you know, America's not seen throughout the world as the last bastion of freedom anymore, is it really?
No. And, you know, a lot of times I have to always ask the question myself, is what's going on a man-made, contrived thing, all this chaos, or is there some supernatural entity that is accelerating things even beyond the control of what man is doing, just to usher in the new paradigm, the new world order, the new thing? Because think about it, 2013 had its share, but 2013 was a relatively slow and not violent year until you got to September in Syria and all that. But for the most part, it was pretty calm. Everybody was talking recovery potential. You know, there was a lot in the alternative media who was saying that, you know, 2013, 2014, something should have happened to the dollar, to gold, silver, but it hasn't yet. And so a lot of those prognosticators who had been saying this is the year it's going to happen, even the Gerald Salentes, they were like not really egg on their face, but they were sitting, pulling back saying, was I wrong? Was I off? But 2014 started out with a bombshell, and it has just gotten worse. And everything is, I mean, from the bringing in of the illegal aliens to wars and more rumors of wars everywhere, Israel deciding once and for all over what should have been a civil incident to go full bore into conflict to try to, you know, rub out Hamas once and for all. Everything is going because I personally think that the timing in the spirit realm is getting to that point that it's now or never. It's coming upon us. But in the earthly realm, places like the United States, Europe, they know, they're looking at the Fed, they're looking at their debt, they're looking at the way the world is moving away from the dollar. We can either try to lead the transition into the next system, which right now they don't have much of a leg to stand on, using military and economic blunt force on all these third world countries, or we can try to bring the world into war, which will then stave off the transition to the new financial system and give us a few more years of respite. And heck, they might win and Russia and China get totally destroyed and the U.S. and Europe and the city of London are still left supreme in the world. You know, which avenue that goes for, I don't know, but we're seeing it unfold right before us.
Well, I think something, and I want to get Doug's take on this, but just a final thought, Doug. I thought it was really interesting that people wrap their head around the fact that V said Saturday, when you hear that word BRICS, folks, you got to remember this isn't just, you know, Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South America. It is 107 countries involved in this this essentially competitor of the IMF. So, I mean, that's just really important.
Yeah, it is. And that's something, by the way, I had no idea of the enormity or the large aspect of BRICS. I just thought it was a handful of countries, and here to find out it's a conglomerate of really a majority of countries. But Kim, let me ask you this, because a lot of people, and I'm not even sure I understand, and I was talking with Joe about this earlier, and we were going through history, and we were going through current events. For the audience that's listening to this, we're trying to get, and I can see a lot of people trying to get a really good handle on the importance, the military, the economic, the technological, whatever, the importance of Ukraine right now, both to Russia and to the West. Can you explain that for people, so in layman's terms, so we can kind of understand the importance of Ukraine to all sides, all parties in this equation here?
Yeah, sure. Ukraine is actually the stepping stone into Central Asia. And as you know from what V talked about, the one thing they are planning on building is the New Silk Road, and Ukraine is vital to the New Silk Road. It also is the only warm water port that at the Crimea that Russia has right now. It's on Russia's border, and the last thing that Russia wants to have to deal with is U.S. and NATO missile bases sitting there right on the border. You know, the way the United States has always had the oceans to protect it, well, Russia has always had its frontier and border states, Poland, Czechoslovakia, Ukraine, et cetera, Hungary, Romania, all those to protect it. Even during the time of war, Germany and Napoleon may have been able to rush through those in short order, but Russia is so vast, by the time they got there, it was late fall, and the winter killed the armies. That being said, the Ukraine is also the pipeline to Europe. Until Russia can build its southern pipeline system that bypasses Ukraine to go along with its northern one, the oil going through and the natural gas going through Ukraine is its sole link to Germany and southern Europe. So for right now, Ukraine is of vast importance in the current geopolitical. Once that Silk Road highway gets through, then Ukraine is going to have a much different outlook in the Eurasian trade zone. And frankly, this is the reason why the U.S.-backed, NATO-backed, the covert ops, et cetera, I believe they knew in advance what Russia was planning to do and the BRICS were planning to do. And they did an end-around and decided to go after Ukraine back in December, because the duly elected president was pro-Russian. And he was going to already in the process of borrowing $15 billion from the Russians. He wasn't going to go through the IMF. And they couldn't have that, because once Ukraine committed to Russia, then Russia was going to not take them over like the old Soviet Union, but they were going to incorporate them into the new Eurasian trade zone. And once that happened, now all of a sudden you have a buttress up against Central Europe, where okay. Ukraine is a buttress against, in Eastern Europe, it's now a buttress against Central Europe, and Germany is just one step away from that partnership with Russia. You bring in the Silk Road that goes all the way to the city of London. The entire geopolitical and economic and financial world changes in an instant, and those oceans that have protected the United States are going to be the gaps and chasms that keep us from prosperity.
Okay, I understand that. And Sheila, you were talking about, I believe you were talking about Anatoly Galitsyn with respect to Russia. And of course, folks, if you don't know who he is, certainly the most important, the most critical Soviet Russian defector ever to make it to the West. He worked, with the KGB in long-range strategy for the Politburo and the Central Committee of the Communist Party. So he had, his books include, and I'm sure many people are familiar with this, New Lies for Old and the Perestroika Deception, that both expose the Soviet strategy of really faking a spectacular collapse of communism to disarm the West. We've seen that. That's come through. But Sheila, I know that you've talked about this before, but now all of a sudden here it seems like we've got the communist-blooded people in our government, whether it be Hillary Clinton, the Kerrys, the Obamas, the these people that their blood runs communist red instead of crimson red, now are going after Putin, I suppose, and attempting to stoke up the war again here. So but now we're seeing through this, and Sheila, I'll just go ahead and turn it back over to you.
That's a really good point, Doug, because you really touched on some key areas. But here's the thing, and I think this is why Ken Shorjan's analysis is so critical. And it's not that I'm defending Russia. So folks, whoever out there is saying, well, it sounds like you're defending Putin. It's not that we're defending Russia or Putin, not at all. But what's extremely very disturbing to me, and I think, Ken, you would find this to be very interesting, is why, up till now, let's face it, I mean, Russia's been extremely patient during this whole conflict in Ukraine. You know, it hasn't sent in troops. It hasn't just said, you know, that's it, we're done. We're sending armaments in, and we're going to solidify our own bases. And they haven't done that in the Crimea. So an act of aggression right now, especially under this BRICS deal, I mean, that would quickly turn the world's opinion against them. And that is probably the most ridiculous strategy that he could ever do, if he's even going to chance swaying nation states away from economic plans of a new, like you just said, the Eurasian trade zone, especially reserve currency and, you know, an alternative financial construct like the BRICS bank is. So, I mean, that just doesn't make any sense on any level. And I think that's the key piece, is that most of the dumbed-down people that are just, you know, allowing the mainstream media to churn their heads full of propaganda, I think that's the piece we're missing is, you know, it's not that we're taking one side, but we just would like to hear the truth. And I think it's disturbing that we have no explanation yet, other than, yeah, Russia did it.
Well, I guess I'm sort of biased, because as a historian, I've liked Russia going back to, you know, the time of Peter the Great, where Russia was just an enclave of a bunch of tribes with a few pieces of aristocracy living in the Dark Ages. And this genius goes to Europe, and he really didn't have anybody he could trust, and he learned everything. He personally learned how to build a ship. He learned dentistry. He learned every single thing he could get his hands on. He took it back to Russia, and he yanked that nation from the Dark Ages into the modern age of the Middle Ages, and started building up a navy and started building up this. You know, interestingly enough, back when I was in the Air Force, I worked at one of my bases was off at, you know, STRATCOM. And each year they had the Colin Powell Joint Inter-Service Warfighting Essay Contest. And so I decided to get into it, and my essay was on Russia's involvement in our Civil War. Most people don't realize Russia was involved in our Civil War. Well, back in that time, when Lincoln was just coming in, the slavery was still a big issue. Tsar Alexander, in the 1850s, signed an agreement freeing the peasants around 1910 completely of their servitude to the aristocracy and to the land, and that they would eventually get their own land and be able to work as free farmers. Well, when Lincoln first did the Emancipation Proclamation, Tsar Alexander saw a brother in arms about releasing freeing the peasants, that he also realized that after the quadrangle and the different wars that Europe had been doing in the early part after Napoleon taking off bits and pieces of Russia, Tsar Alexander said, look, I see a civil war where both England and France are going to get involved on the side of the bankers. We saw that, where Maximilian took over Mexico, and there was 8 to 20,000 British troops in Canada ready to come in on the U.S. government. So what Russia did was they sent ships and offered them freely to Lincoln to patrol the east and west coast to keep the French from coming up through Mexico, from the English through Canada. And it was because of that, at the end of the war, Russia wanted some reparations for the use of their navy. And, well, constitutionally, since we really didn't have a formal agreement with them, the government, Andrew Johnson, really didn't have any legal aspect to pay them. So in return, they paid $7.2 million for a piece of territory that had been Russia's, known as Alaska. And that was the real reason we bought Alaska, was to pay reparations for the use of the Russian Navy during Civil War. So what I'm saying in all this is that Russia has never, up until the Lenin and Bolshevik Revolution, Russia has almost always been an ally of the United States. Everything changed then, and I don't think it was necessarily because of Russia things changed. I think it was because 1921, we had the creation of the, not the Trilateral Commission, but what was the other one? The CFR.
League of Nations.
Council for Relations, 1921. CFR. They wanted a global nation. And with that being said, Russia was a thorn in that, and so they created that enemy from that time on. So, you know, I've always been a fan of Russia in history. I don't always approve of what their leaders do, but Putin is not trying to recreate the Soviet Union, no matter what anybody says. He's a nationalist. He's trying to protect his homeland. And if you were in the KGB at the fall of the Soviet Empire, and the U.S. made some promises, especially economic ones, saying, hey, if you break communism and you tear down this wall, we will come in and we will help build up your economy and your business, and then find out that the U.S. backed away from their promises, I'd be in the same situation where I am now, you know. So I can see exactly where Putin's coming from. He doesn't trust the U.S. I wouldn't if I were him either. But he loves Russia as a nationalist, and he's trying his best, even willing to make agreements with former enemies, communist China, because they realize that the world is not about military and conquest. It's about who controls the economic system really controls the world.
But it's also about who controls the information. Let's not forget, of course, good old President Commander-in-Chief is, I won't even repeat what I call him, Doug, but I'll keep it clean. But let's not forget Obama, Joe Biden, John Kerry. I mean, look at Syria. You know, when it was discovered there's chemical weapons, Syrian people, wow, the U.S. was quick to blame Bashar for genocide, and there was zero evidence, you know, to prove anything in a weapon of mass destruction, yet it was eventually determined that, you know, U.S. funded Benghazi-armed Al-Qaeda rebels, and, you know, Washington shut up entirely, and the story was crickets chirping. So I guess the U.S. is not completely innocent in all this, is it, Ken?
No, and the U.S. hasn't really been innocent since, at least, you know, I'll give this credit, at least since the fall of the Soviet Union. Once the U.S. became the sole superpower, they had two different options to go, to either do everything in its power to remain the superpower, or they could use their power benevolently. And, you know, if you look through time and history, we use both economic, foreign aid, and military as a blunt instrument for our own national agenda, not for the betterment of people. You know, democratizing the world, well, that's just another means of saying we're going to come in and we're going to rob your central bank, and we're going to build bases on there.
Exactly, and I find it interesting too that in December, I think it was, I could be wrong in the month, but don't forget Victoria Nuland, fresh off of a junket to Kiev, had boasted. She spoke before a United States Ukraine Foundation in D.C., and she had said that the U.S. had invested more than $5 billion into the Ukraine over the past, 20 years to promote democratic institutions and a good form of government. And at the time, there was a video of her speech that had gone viral, so to speak. She failed to break down any of that $5 billion with respect to where it went, the recipients. It's very interesting to look at the background. And I think, you know what, Ken and Sheila and Joe and I just really think that we, the American people, and the people of the West, are just being sold such a bill of goods here. And as we are rushed, pushed headlong into World War III. I mean, because this is just like Syria. I mean, this is what wars are started from. Are they not?
Oh, certainly. I think the U.S. eventually wants a war. They want the war on their terms. They want the war where the world is on their side. You know, it's the same thing that you and other guests or guest speakers have been saying on here. One of the reasons why the people don't, come and uprise like they should after all these years is because the U.S. government is waiting for the people to react first so they can have the public justification for their response. It's the same thing here. They're trying to egg the frog to jump, so once they jump, then they can, quote-unquote, justify coming in and doing what they have to do. If the U.S. comes in overtly you know, obviously they've had to work covertly in Benghazi, covertly in Egypt, covertly in Syria, and now covertly in Ukraine, because the moment they do it overtly, then the world opinion turns completely from them. So they're trying to get Russia to jump, make the first move, so then they can come in and justify their overt actions.
And Sheila, you and I spoke, and I know that you've done a lot of research on this, and Ken, you talked about the Council on Foreign Relations. Lest we forget, the old billionaire king of, well, the media darling, shall we say, George Soros.
Soros.
Oh, man. He's got his grubby fingerprints. I mean, if we would take a... If we take our crime scene kit out there and dust for prints on Ukraine, I think we'd find Soros prints everywhere on this.
Well, and Doug, do you find it interesting that you would find this interesting, Doug, and I know Ken knows this, that ever since, well, it's not just Soros, but, you know, the billionaire boys club like Bill Gates and Warren Buffett, ever since they said they're going to give all their money away, do you notice, Ken, what's happened?
Yeah. Ever since, and I think I mentioned this to Sheila when we were talking earlier, ever since Warren Buffett and Bill Gates said that they were going to give all their money away, you know their net worth has doubled?
Yeah, how does that work? Hey, by the way, I'm going to give all my, I'm going to empty my bank account. It's all four figures. I'm going to empty my bank account. No.
See, this is, the Bill Gates Foundation is the new 21st Century Ford Foundation. If you think about it in that terms, you are dead on. Okay? The point is that what do they support the supply with? They don't supply it with cash. They supply it with stock. What has the stock market done ever since they've created the Gates Foundation? It's gone from 9,000 to 17,000. So all this stock that they hold in these trusts have doubled. They still own the stock. It's just under a different holding company, and so their value goes up. Yeah,
very
you know,
interesting
it's,
point.
Wait, I'm thinking of Rocky and Bullwinkle. Nothing up my sleeve. Nothing up my sleeve.
Well, Doug, we're going to open up I just want to remind callers that we're going to open up the phone lines when we come back in a few minutes after the break because, you know, it's just pretty much, I mean, we just want to hear from our listeners, don't we, on what's sort of their take on everything going on right now. And as V said, the phrase bullet train coming at us on, you know, every side. And I think it's just imperative that people use, you know, their common sense, their logic, their spirit, their discernment to really think about what's happening, what's playing out here in the bigger picture. And this is quite frightening and disturbing that we are being told essentially that, hey, Russia's a bad guy, we got to go in there now, we got to do something. I mean, what's happening, folks, is these Kabbalah collectivists is trying to rocket speed us into World War III. That's what's happening, essentially, isn't it, Ken?
Yeah, and, you know, there was another incident I forgot to mention in this whole thing, World War I. You know, Kaiser Wilhelm was part of the Kabbalah. You know, the aristocracy that was bought and paid for by the Rothschilds. Tsar Nicholas, who was in charge of Russia at the time, they were cousins.
Yeah.
And after the Archduke Ferdinand was shot, Tsar Nicholas was begging, sent five communiques. Look, we can deal with this. We can get this. Don't go to war. We don't need this. But it was Germany who set the thing in motion. And, you know, we saw what happened after that.
Well, and let's not forget Rothschild's the old financial luminary. He's backed every side of war too, hasn't he?
Oh, exactly. Every war is a banker war. This is all about finance. There's a reason why Jesus talked about money more times in the New Testament than the kingdom of God. I mean, than anything but the kingdom of God, because the concept of money is the central factor for just about everything. You know, as an investigator, I'm sure Doug and Joe, you know what? Follow the money. It's the same thing here as the question I asked. Who benefits? Who would benefit? Why would this even come about? There's always random chance in the world, but I rarely find pure coincidence on a large scale to be random chance.
Joe, before I turn it to the break, folks, chew on this for a moment. just chew on this fact. And Ken and Sheila, I don't know if you've heard this or not. MH17 flew its first test flight, get this, on 7/17/1997, 17 years to the day before it was shot down. It was delivered on 7/29/97. Just as a kind of a interesting little tidbit of information. Joe?
With that, we are going to go to the break. We're going to come right back to your Hagmann and Hagmann Report. We are joined by our special guest, Ken Shorjan, writer for The Examiner on the Internet and RogueMoney.net V-site, and Sheila Zielinski, the host of the Weekend Vigilante right here on Saturdays with the Hagmann and Hagmann Report. We're going to be taking your phone calls in this second hour, answering questions with Ken and Sheila about this Malaysian flight and, you know, anything on the economic front that is important. And I did see a couple of, maybe I can jump in here with the first question. Along with the BRICS nations teaming up, I saw today that the Swiss National Bank and the People's Bank of China reached a currency swap agreement. And the Swiss, now this is just one of many nations that have reached currency agreements with China. How is this going to affect the BRICS nations and what they're doing? Or is this bolstering exactly what we're seeing with the BRICS nations?
It's just part of the infrastructure. What you see a lot, you know, there were 27 nations, including Britain, including Germany. Those two countries, about 3 months ago, created swap lines. So really what this is news, but really it's just the foundations to be able to trade in the BRICS Bank, the new BRICS infrastructure, the Eurasian Trade Zone. It's also preparation for the day the yuan will become convertible. Not that it'll become the reserve currency, but that it'll be convertible and get out there. You know, Jim Woolley was talking an interview about a week ago with Paul Sandu, and he believes that the yuan is very shortly going to be overvalued by 30%. They're going to raise their value against the dollar to strengthen it at about the point that they bring it for full convertibility. And so it's going to appear, at least on the surface, as a more viable currency than the dollar will be. And if it's sort of going to be a test case, because they're going to put it out there, they're going to see which countries are willing to accept it, which in trade. And if there's a lot of nations that jump right on it, then they're just going to go ahead and run with it, and you could see the transition within 6 months to a year.
Wow. So, folks, you can see how this all fits together in a very interesting kind of like a stair-step pattern, I think. Very interesting.
Yeah, and it's, you know, the other article I saw today that it says the, I never pronounced this right, the renminbi? Go ahead.
Renminbi.
There you go. It's on track to become the third largest international currency behind the U.S. dollar and the euro within 5 years as China accelerates its promotion of the yuan. This from a University of China report released on Sunday. So, you know, there are other financial articles that go right along with what you were saying there, Ken. You guys want to take calls or you want to comment on that, Ken?
Oh, no, you're going to see a lot of news information like that. Some of it is just going to be what they'd like to do, what they'd like to project. Some of it may not actually come to fruition. So you take all that with a grain of salt. I'm more of the lines of when Europe starts doing things like the Swiss creating swap lines, then I'm going to believe it. But there's, you know, just because I'm pointing tonight at U.S. propaganda doesn't mean that I don't believe that there's Chinese and Russian propaganda out there too.
Yeah, if there's any country that we should, that was one of the questions I was thinking that we see enter into, you know, these currency swaps. What would be a red flag country for you that, you know, should really make people? I mean, if they're not already part of the
Oh, BRICS. When Germany moves, it's over.
Okay.
Yeah.
Forget all the other countries. Forget all the other countries. Germany, who runs the Eurozone? Once Germany leaves, it's done. It's over. And Germany only has 3,000 businesses that do business in Russia. And, you know, that's why this is so important.
Though, Ken, you know, it's important for people to understand, it's not just like BRICS was thrown together last week. This thing's been in the making for years.
Well, the irony is that the BRICS didn't even name themselves. Back in the emerging markets before 2008, some buffoon at Goldman Sachs saw them as the emerging markets and coined them the BRIC. It was actually originally BRIC, but South Africa, because it's resource and mining, signed on after 2008, 2009, when these emerging markets say, you know what? We have the potential here to make a coalition, a strong trading coalition. Let's do it. And that's really where it was born. Because if you think about it, I'm sorry, the BRICS summit that took place this week was only the sixth BRICS summit. So it's only been around for 6 years.
Well, and I seem to remember a writer at the Financial Times throwing around that term, and I think he took credit for coining it, but you are right. It was some good old luminary there.
Personally, so, I would have gone with crib, but that's just my personal reference.
No, I don't know, because I think that the term goes well with an old song by the Commodores.
Okay.
Something about a brick house, you know.
Okay. We're dating ourselves here. Wow. Okay.
Well, let's go to the phones. And we do have some callers on hold, and the number is 661-244-9839. That's 661-244-9839 if you want to jump on and ask a question. We're going to go to area code 916. 916, thanks for holding. You're live on the Hagmann & Hagmann Report with Ken and Sheila. What's on your mind tonight? 916.
Going once, 916.
All right,
let's move on. And folks, please turn down your whatever you're listening to, whatever device, please turn that down, and be as succinct as possible when you ask your question.
All right, 805-805, we're coming to you now. You're live on the Hagmann and Hagmann Report. 805? All right. All right, third time's the charm. 3-2-1. How about that? 3-2-1. You're live on the Hagmann and Hagmann Report with Ken and Sheila.
Hello.
Good evening. 3-2-1.
Hello?
Yeah, go ahead and ask your question. You're breaking up a little bit, but go ahead.
Okay. This is 3-2-1. Can you hear me now?
Yes,
I can hear you.
Oh, I can't believe I'm talking to you guys. I've been trying to call you for the longest time. I am a new listener, and I just woke up, maybe not quite 2 years ago. And I got to tell you, I remember after I was being so patriotic, and I know I'm really off topic right now, but just the fact that I'm actually talking to somebody who, like, can totally understand me is huge. This whole thing is so new to me, and still new and still shocking. And I don't know the right word for it, but it just continues to overwhelm me daily. And if it wasn't for being a born-again Christian, I don't know how in the world I would ever handle all this. This, what I would call like almost an alternate reality, even though it is the real reality, it, up until I became awake, I would say that was the alternate reality, you know. I was doing a patriotic thing the day after 9/11. A couple years ago, I'm looking for the rebroadcast, and that led me down some extremely dark avenues. And it was at that point that I just couldn't get enough. And every time I thought I'd seen it all, something else would come along, and something else would come along. And finally, I came across your website and started listening to rebroadcasts of your show through YouTube. And now I'm actually listening live every night, if possible. And I just cannot tell you how grateful that I am that you guys do what you do, because I don't know what kind of world my kids are going to have, my teenage boys are going to have, but I know it's not going to be anything like the one I had growing up. And I've not minced a whole lot of words with them about any of this. You know, they're old enough to know, and they need to know. And on that note, I would like to know how to reach children my age in a manner that's effective about this whole world that is our world. Because like I said, up until the recent past, you know, I was living in a fairy tale land. And I can remember the morning after learning a lot of this stuff, pulling away from the curb of their school, thinking, yesterday I didn't know any of this stuff. And I found myself wishing I could go back. But we all know that's not an alternative.
You know what, Ken and Sheila, I mean, look, I was the same way. It took me a long time to really understand what in the world is going on. Sheila, you know what, you've got children, and when I say children, the older children, mine are all grown and out of the house. Ken, I'm not sure, but how do you explain all of this to your kids, Sheila?
Well, one of the things I do with my children, I have three sons, and each one of them I have just told them the truth, basically. And, you know, I woke up pretty young. I'd say I got a copy of a book when I was 12. My uncle was a pastor, a preacher, and he gave me a copy of a book called When Your Money Fails. And let me tell you, that was a rude awakening. I think I was 11 or something when that came out. I've always been really honest with my children. One of my oldest son, he always rolls his eyes and he goes, oh, don't ever take my mom to a movie. You never hear the end of the New World Order. But the thing is, I'm just really, you know, you said the word alternative reality, and it is. I mean, a person, when they're really awake, they kind of wish they could just be, you know, back to their dumbed down dystopic trance that they're used to walking around in. And I think that's the key issue for people is, once you wake up, I mean, there's no turning back. But I think the biggest thing you mentioned is you are a Christian. And that's, you know, I think Ken can agree on this. It's often that we feel like we're looking at this scenario playing out, but we're really unaffected by it spiritually because we know, you know, how the story ends. But in the meantime, you know, I think it's just important that people try to wake up everyone they can, present the facts. You know, don't do it in an aggressive way, but just lay out the facts, and eventually I think the truth always it really does set you free, and I think that's the important thing. Ken, do you have any comments?
Oh, I agree. I agree very much with what you said, and if I could add a few things, just from my perspective, you know, when I almost want to equate speaking about things that are outside of the norm, outside of the paradigm, it's the equivalent of preaching the gospel to an unbeliever. First off, you have to get in your mind this. We don't bring people to Jesus. Nothing can work unless the Spirit is working in them. This is why a lot of times we'll talk to somebody over and over and over and over, and we'll get frustrated and we'll say, you know what, how come they don't get it? How come they don't? If the Spirit's not involved, it doesn't matter what you say. It's the same thing when talking about these things that are outside their paradigm. What's happening? These, you know, super secret agencies, because most people are grow up with what their grandparents taught them and what their parents taught them. America is the land of the free and the brave and justice for all. And, well, when you get down to the core of it, to be honest, there were pockets of time when the United States wasn't even like that in the 1820s, two decades after we became a nation. There have always been pockets of time when corrupt people and corrupt leaders have done things that have not been of what we consider the American way. Now, when you're talking to your children, I would look at it more of this. You don't focus on the evil. You don't focus on the bad things that are coming about. What you do is you go back to the root core. You talk about the good. You know, it's something I talked to Michael Arevna one time, and I asked him about, you know, when we were talking about when he was looking at the new dollar bill or $100 bill and looking at all the different symbols and all that. And I said, you know, don't they, when it comes to the counter, you know, the Secret Service, they don't study the bad bills. They don't study the counterfeits. They don't study the evil things. They study the true article. And that way they know that every single nuance of the true article, so they can pick out a counterfeit without even looking, because they know the true. It's the same thing here. Don't worry about all the news, because all the news will overwhelm you. All the bad stuff will overwhelm you. I mean, imagine what the Christians in the Roman Empire between the time of Jesus Christ and the fall in, you know, 400 A.D. Imagine the iniquity and all the evil they had to endure during that time. It's no different than us today. You know, technology and things are more intense, per se, but they still had to deal with the same types of corruption and evil, wickedness, persecution that we're experiencing today. Don't focus on that. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That's where it all comes about.
And that's excellent advice. Thank you, caller from 321. Glad you got through. And thanks for calling in. We're going to move right along here. We're going to go to area code 407. 407, thanks for holding. You're live on the Hagmann and Hagmann Report. And I hear the time delay. All right, 407.
Hello.
Good evening.
Hey, Doug and Joe, how's it going?
Very well. You have a question for
Good,
Ken?
Good, I appreciate you taking my call.
Sure.
Hey, I just had to first start out by thanking you guys for Saturday's show. It was incredible. Sheila did such a great job, and Tom Horn and your other two guests. It was really, I watched it, the archive show yesterday, and it was just a really incredible show. You guys really stepped up a notch, so thank you for doing that. And, you know, I wanted to ask your caller, you know, I've been doing a lot of research lately. You know, I'm kind of I've kind of gone down this rabbit trail myself. I'm an adjunct professor, and the more I started looking into this whole, hopefully this pans out and makes sense, this Jesuit connection that's going on, it's really kind of frightening. They seem to have their hand in, you know, the majority of decisions being made, not just, you know, from the Vatican, but also political decisions and stuff like that. You look back at their history, you know, they've always had their hand in major conflicts going on like this. So, you know, your caller was doing such an interesting job tonight. I was wondering what his take was, you know, on any connection like that, them pulling the strings, something going on in the Ukraine. What is their feeling about Russia? You know, I mean, where are they posturing themselves in this whole thing? You know, I had passed on something to Doug last week that I came across that was kind of amazing. And in my research, I came across, you know, this FEMA map breakdown of the United States, these FEMA regions, you know. And if you compare the FEMA region breakdown to the breakdown the Catholic Church has done of the United States into provinces, because they all want to return to that provincial Roman government where everybody, you know, kind of is has to answer directly to the Pope. I mean, that's their eventual end game. The two maps are identical. So, I mean, I don't want to get off tangent, you know, going down this other road, but I'd really be interested to see, you know, your caller seems like he has a lot of wisdom in this area, and I'd like to see what he has to think about that. So, thanks.
All right, my friend.
Okay,
Ken. Yeah, Ken. I know you're aware. You're pretty familiar with what he's referring to.
Yeah, personally, I think Ukraine really is sort of a sideshow in the sense. I mean, it does have vast importance, but if you were to ask me what the Jesuits are doing right now, all you got to do is look on the Vatican throne. They are building up and solidifying the one world religion. That's their goal right now. Everything else is sort of, you know, on the side. They may be involved because, you know, the Jesuits are pretty much all over the place. But their primary thing is getting the one world religion. The other side of the coin is Russia and the U.S. and whoever the powers that be behind each side. They're trying for the one world economic system at this point. So that's just my thoughts on that.
Sheila, let me ask you a question, because you and I have spoken off air, you, me, and Joe, and Steve Quayle, and of course others, but doesn't it seem like they're racing right now to a specific time, date certain, if you will, to get everything accomplished? They're really kind of putting the pedal to the metal, so to speak. Don't you think so?
Yeah, they are, because, you know, we're talking about all these incidences and I mean, on all fronts. I mean, you know, I just have to repeat it. I mean, when you look at the repetition of history bearing its ugly head over and over and over, you know, what is at stake right now? You know, economic dominion, vilification, the empire. It's the same playbook, you know, when you springboard back 100 years ago, like Ken just said. I mean, there's always throughout history very evil, sinister, maniacal, nefarious people, but the bottom line is that this is all, I mean, get your hand on the Bible, folks, and start taking a look at Isaiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, Revelation 13 is a great one. And, of course, we all know Pastor David Langford wrote an incredible book, and if you don't have it, get it, because I don't think I've ever saw a better breakdown of Revelation 13 coming to pass. You know, we're talking about the false prophet, the Antichrist, the mark of the beast. This is all bullet training towards fulfilled prophecy, and as Tom Horn says, prophecy is on fire right now. It's in our intro for our weekend show. It is. It's on fire, and that is, you know, that's a key factor that people have to look at is the Bible. What was predicted 2,000 years ago? You know, there's 66 books in the Bible that we know, and it's all coming to pass. And I don't know what else to say other than that on that topic, Doug.
All right.
Well, one thing I'd like to add in this, from the spiritual point of view, okay, we know from Revelation what the destiny and the end goal of Satan is. We know what the destiny and the end goal of Messiah is. What did he say when you see these things? The diversity of earthquakes, the rumors, wars and rumors of wars, the persecution. He said one thing, and this is the most important thing. He said, look up. He didn't say, look out. He didn't say, try to change it. He didn't say, try to fight it. He said, look up. That's really what our goal is, and pretty much is see these things, you know, when we become a new creature and we are in the kingdom of God, and we are our lives are no longer our own, which is what the scripture says. We are really ambassadors here on earth from the kingdom of God. We're not United States Americans. We're not Germans. We're not what we are. Those who have truly become born again and have given themselves to Christ are ambassadors on the thing. Well, when you have an embassy in a location, as an ambassador, you don't try to change the society or the country you're in. What you do is you stand there and allow people to come to you so they can learn about your kingdom. When they come, want to get a visa, they want to visit your kingdom. They want to know about what you are and what it is. And I think more than anything, that's what we've got to focus on, learn all the fundamentals, and through our fruit, be that beacon, that ambassador, so people can say, you know what? The world's going to hell in a handbasket. I can no longer do this of my own accord. I can't find a job. I've got no money. You know, the things are just, the fear is getting great. My health is going bad. You know, you're walking in joy and contentment. Any one of us who are Christians, if somebody comes up to us, what do you have that I want? And that's the thing, is I think more than anything we need to, when we express to people, is show the importance of who we are in Christ more than we do of, you know, let's join this movement and try to take back what eventually is going to fail anyway.
Very well said. Very well said. And folks, I mean, think about that. Joe?
Yeah, let's. We have a bunch of callers on the line, so we're going to go right back to the phones, get to as many of these as possible. 414, area code 414. Thanks for holding. We're coming to you now. You're live on the Hagmann and Hagmann Report.
Hi, Joe and Doug and Sheila, correct?
Yeah,
that's
Ken.
Correct. And Ken, yep.
Yes, I'd just like to thank you guys for everything you guys do. And I listen a lot in Wisconsin. I'd like to also let you guys know that I pray for you guys a lot of times when I do pray. So when Brother Quayle says we pray for intercessors, I'm praying for you guys too. I just have one question, and is when is Brother Quayle coming back on? I like the other guests too, but Brother Quayle is one of my favorites.
Tomorrow night, sir. Tomorrow night.
Tomorrow
didn't
night.
Announce it yet. Yep, but Pastor David Langford and Steve Quayle will be on tomorrow night.
Thank you.
But did you have a question for Ken or Sheila?
No, not really. Maybe just one. Was there any other information on IMF Christine's so-called numerology and something in the what was going to happen in the markets with maybe a crash and then the silver going up? That was only my only question.
All right, thanks, Bob.
I'll throw a little numerology thing that people didn't realize, but 15 July. As you know, remember when W had mentioned that date, the day of the gate when the dollar and the silver would go electronically, and of course Lagarde was the 20th. Well, the interesting thing about July 15th was it was 17 Tammuz on the calendar, and 17 Tammuz was the day of the fall of the first temple, I believe, and it coincides with, of course, the 9th of Av. They are intrinsically tied, so. If that helps any, that's the only thing I found in regards to special days with the 15th and the 20th.
That's pretty interesting. Well, Ken, since we kind of strayed into that genre, and you, I'm sure you saw Christine Lagarde's rather bizarre press conference at the National Press Club back in January, where she went into the occult numerology whole venue.
Well, what was the important thing she said at the very beginning? She said,
"I'm not in charge."
I have to say this. You know, they're making me say this, or in paraphrased words. So. You know the rules of the game. See, this is the interesting thing, and I like to take this from L.A. Marzulli and a lot of what he's taught. If the Earth is a testing ground, that's an extension of the original war in heaven, where Satan still has powers and dominions. You know, we know in the Old Testament that he went into the throne room with the sons of God in the book of Job. And then we have mankind. There are certain laws and rules that have to be followed. And I'm pretty sure people like Steve and Tom Horn and a few others have said this before. For some reason, Satan, his minions, the Illuminati, yada, yada, they always have to tell people what they're going to do before they do it. And I think that's it probably goes back to a spiritual law that was part of the bargain for this whole mankind on Earth. You know, the choice of if I make a creation on Earth, man, who is he going to choose? Is he going to choose to worship you, or is he going to choose to worship me? Free will. Boom, boom. Now, there are rules we've got to do in this. One is that everything that you do, you have to show man what you're going to do beforehand. Just like God's law is, in Genesis, he gave dominion over the earth to man, and in no other scripture, period, did he ever take it back. This is why in the Lord's Prayer isn't a rote prayer we're supposed to do. It's a template. You know, Jesus was talking to the disciples. They were asking him how I should pray, not what I should pray. The Lord's Prayer is a template. You know, we are to seek forgiveness for our sins, lay out the sins, go through, and then repent. Then we are to enter his gates with thanksgiving, thank him for our daily bread, thank him for all the things. And then we are to enter his courts in praise. You know, but what is the one thing in that prayer? Let thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's speaking a surrendering of our dominion that God gave in Genesis to man. That's a literal speaking it and giving it back to God so that he can work in us and on the earth. You know, that was the purpose behind saying that, because if God had dominion over the earth and could do anything he wanted, then saying that is superfluous, is it not? Because he already had it. This is the power of the tongue. This is the power of prayer. There are purposes and reasons behind everything that we say and do. And that's what's lost in the church. They don't even teach these fundamentals. And this is why a lot of times when people pray, nothing happens. Because they were never, if the apostles asked one thing, or the disciples asked one thing of Christ, how do I pray? They didn't have to ask anything else, because if you know how to pray and the meanings and reasons behind it, then you have the power of everything in the authority. So, you know, there are rules in this chessboard of earth and man and the evil one and God. And, you know, in the end, it's a matter of if you understand those rules and you're able to work and function in the authority and the power, then really there's nothing that Satan can do that can really hinder us.
Amen. And on, you know, Sunday's show, we were on with Brother Marcus, one of the things that was said on that show was, you know, getting back to the basics in your faith. And, you know, that's one thing that we have to do as Christians. And you said it earlier, Ken, you know, you have to make sure that you yourself are on the right track before you can be on the right track. The Spirit will be the one that's in charge when that happens. But you need to make sure that you're constantly and diligently seeking the Spirit.
Oh, amen. Yeah.
From the moment you get up
to the moment you go to bed.
Yeah, it has to be the main point of focus, or else, you know, I can see how you would lose your mind and with all this news and headlines going on. We're going to go to area code 830. 830, you're live on the Hagmann and Hagmann Report with Ken and Sheila. What's on your mind tonight?
How y'all doing?
Fantastic. How about you?
I'm good. Hey, I was just wanting to let y'all know that actually I just started listening to you, I guess about a week ago or so. But I don't understand how Christians don't want to talk about this. I have Christian family members. One of them's a preacher. I mentioned it yesterday. We're watching the news. And they just are like, do not want to discuss it. I don't understand that thinking. It just blows my mind. I guess
like
they're
the old saying,
fear.
Ignorance is bliss, as they say. And
I guess so, but I wanted y'all to know that the other night you had Nathan Leal?
Nathan Leal, yeah.
He's amazing. I went and listened to some of his stuff off his website, and actually I listened to the Chaos one about, you know, everything that y'all had discussed about the tattoos and about all that mess that's on its way in, and the bloodletting and the occult connection and the ceremony of it, and that was an eye-opener. And I absolutely got it. I'm like, that is so true. But anyway, I just wanted y'all to know, I wanted to thank you for that, And I really like the variety of people that you have on this thing. And I wanted to tell you the first time that I realized that something was going on or Jesus was coming was when Fukushima happened, or actually the oil spill. And then when Fukushima happened, my husband said, there's an earthquake and a tsunami in Japan. I said, Jesus is coming. He thought I was crazy because he's not a Christian. But I said, Jesus is coming. And I was just on cloud 100 for a week. And but I'm excited, y'all. It's terrible things are coming this way, and I know we're going to be enduring persecution. I know we're going to go through that. We were always taught the rapture, but I always believe that, but not so much anymore. At all.
Sheila, go ahead.
Well, churches don't want to talk about it. You're right. I don't think ever, I don't even know a time in history where we've ever witnessed more gross teaching and false doctrine than today. And due to the love of money, you know, whether it's these hucksters or false doctrine or false prophets, you know, they've been able to corrupt and distort true biblical issues. I mean, we know that false prophets have intentionally and willfully represented and misrepresented the Word of God. And, you know, they use all this plethora of deceptive methods in an attempt to distort biblical doctrine. And that's the thing, these mendacious teachings, they've exploded everywhere in these last days. Mm. I mean, you know, don't forget, Satan has a purpose and intent in causing you to fall from your own steadfastness in God. I mean, he wants the doom and damn for every soul that he possibly can. And, you know, you got to remember Paul the Apostle prophesied a solemn warning concerning the love of money and the concern of false doctrine. You know, these people have pierced themselves through with many sorrows. And I think we're seeing that mock speeding toward us now. Just an absolute, what did Tom Horn say Saturday? He said, you know, the old school preachers, this isn't what that kind of Christianity was. What's going on today, we don't even know what that is, but it's definitely not the same kind of thing that was happening with the New Testament disciples, that's for sure.
Well, it's absolutely warp speed. I am just amazed at just how quickly everything is, just going. I'm like, my gosh, next year, I mean, I could definitely be in a FEMA camp. So, I mean, I'm just mentally preparing myself for that, and I'm preparing my kids, too. My youngest son is 21, and he at first, you know, wasn't sure, but now he's calling me. He's never read. He's reading a book. He's reading his Bible. He's like, Mom, I'm going to be ready, and I feel like God wants me to minister. And I said, absolutely. That's why we're here. We're not here to have a good time. We're here to serve the Lord and to reach others for Christ. We're not here to be coddled and enjoy ourselves and be raptured out. We're here to work. And, you know, this idea that, you know, we're going to escape any kind of hardship is just unbelievable. And you know what? I was one of those that believed it. And the Osteen thing just blows my mind. You know, it was like one day God opened my eyes, and now I can't hardly stand him. I turn the channel. I'm like, I cannot listen to that guy. He's so deceptive. It's so sly and sneaky. Satan, you know, the guy probably thinks he's just doing wonderful things, but Satan is using him in a mighty way. And but I'm glad my eyes were open to that.
I would just suggest one thing, and this is just coming from the spiritual side. Don't worry about, you know, Jesus said, you know, take no thought of tomorrow. Focus on today. Okay, if the things of FEMA or the government or whatever come, then they come. But don't carry that fear around, and that's what a lot of people do.
I'm absolutely not afraid.
Right,
I'm
don't carry that fear around. Or the expectation of fear, because these are the things that bring about doubt and unbelief. And if doubt and unbelief is even a minuscule part, then it is really difficult to trust. And if we don't have trust, then the times we need to call upon the spirit for power and for manifestation, this is why Peter sank in the boat. Okay? He looked out on the world said, you can't do this, and boom. So this is what I always temper people with. Yes, this is true news. These are things going on. But we walk in a much different world. We are in the world, but not of the world. We do have the power to not be completely affected by what the rest of the world is being affected by, because we have the promise and the authority and the power to be able to supersede when it's according to his will. And in the other times, you know what? If it's my time, then go. I'm more than happy to do whatever. But that's the thing I would just temper with. Never let the fear, never let the, because those things create the doubt and unbelief that really keep Christians from being able to do what they're supposed to do and to also hear from the Lord when he's saying, do a particular thing.
Very good answer, caller. Thank you very much for that call. Ken, I have an email question here from Paul, who's listening live over breakfast in Taiwan. Wow. Drink that coffee, have your orange juice and toast in Taiwan. Paul wants to know this, your take on this, Ken, and also this goes for Sheila, too, given your both of your level of research knowledge about this recent Flight 17, Malaysian Flight 17. Paul writes that, now I'm gonna just boil this down to essentially a couple of questions here. It's a paragraph and a half. But he says, look, the Malaysian Flight 17 was reportedly shot down. There appears to be some inconsistencies with respect to the observations made regarding the bodies. Now, having said that, he goes on to reference the missing Malaysian flight that supposedly is at the bottom of some ocean somewhere. And then there's also a reference that he makes to a Malaysian flight that's on the tarmac at an airport in Tel Aviv over some type of leasing discrepancy or dispute, all being the same type of aircraft, that is 777. Are there, what's going on here, basically, is what he wants to know. Ken, I'm going to toss it to you first.
You know, Sheila actually sent me an email while we were talking today, what my thoughts or discernment were regarding the flight that got shot down in the Ukraine and the flight that disappeared over, you know, Diego Garcia, per se. And I asked the Holy Spirit, and I did not, the Spirit was saying that this is not the same plane. Now, as for the other things, I would just temper with this. There could be some feasibility as being a part of it, but we're still in that point where there's so much information, disinformation, minutiae out there that until we get evidence and start distilling it into some facts, I usually set those items aside as, okay, I recognize them, I remember them, but they really don't fit into the puzzle yet.
Gotcha. Sheila, anything on your end through your research, your investigation, your inquiries?
Well, I think the point is there's so much disinformation, and there's this, you know, ostensibly you have to look on behalf of, these air traffic controllers. There's lots of them talking, whether it's RT or other things. I mean, who knows? This is the big question. I mean, we can make all the formulations that we want, but there's these international experts saying, how come they didn't account for the missiles air-to-ground to air ammo and anti-aircraft missiles? And there's other people that are looking sort of more at the Ukrainian Air Force aircraft on the day of the tragedy. You know, there was this objective control on the movement of it. So, why is the Ukrainian air traffic controllers allowed deviation of a route of that north side of the anti-terrorist operation zone? That's a good question. You know, why was I keep thinking about the civilian aircraft airspace over the combat zone. I mean, especially in an area where there's no solid field of radar navigation. So, yeah, there's 10 million and one questions, but, you know, that's why I was so shocked when the American lamestream media was pumping out the fact that, you know, nothing to see here if Russia did it. Because I don't believe that based on the evidence. I mean, Doug, you're an investigator. And, you know, how were the lessons from previous similar disasters like that Russian back in the Black Sea in 2001? I mean, the leaders of Ukraine, until the last minute, they denied any involvement of the armed forces of the country. It's like, no, nothing to see here. So, you know, we have to sort of look at the bigger, broader picture. I mean, we may never find the truth out. Doug, as you know, there's other things, Benghazi to name one. We'll probably never know the truth, and that's the unfortunate part of the world we live in today. We're just being fed nothing but what the media wants us to know.
Thanks. Good answers to both. And Paul, thanks very much for your email question. Again, from Taiwan, truly reaching far parts of the globe.
All right, let's go back to the phones. Let's go to area code 610. 610, you're live on the Hagmann and Hagmann Report with Ken and Sheila. What's on your mind tonight?
Hello?
Yeah, that's you. You're live on the Hagmann and Hagmann Report.
Oh. Hi, how are you guys all doing?
Good.
I was listening to the topics from tonight and the scope and where it's going from Russia to the plain economics and spirituality, and I've called in before, and I've said before that all these things are so linked together, it's ridiculous. But one thing that you guys were hitting on tonight, and you hit on every night, but so many people out there really don't understand or fathom just how it's going to really touch the economics, the spiritual, how much it's going to touch into their lives in this country, in the United States. They see the meat prices going up a little bit, and they start, I'm a good prepper because I put a bunch of rice in my cabinets. Or that's really not the way it's going to work in the end. I mean, in the end of this country, as they transfer into a North American Union and change our dollar, the way things are going to work in this country, the FEMA camps weren't built for us. They were built for who's in there now. We're going to be the ones out in the street living in dirt huts, and they're going to be the new Americans.
Well, I can't see anything wrong with that line of reasoning. Sheila, Ken?
Well, the bottom line is I love what I think it was V that said. Somebody said this, the ultimate prep is Jesus, whether it was W or V. I can't remember who coined this phrase, but I love it. You know, the bottom line, that is really the bottom line, isn't it?
It
really is. Yeah.
It is. And you can't stop just giving the grace to Jesus, because look at what Abram was asked to put his son on the altar. And the angel said to him, to God, he said, wait a minute, whoa, this guy's going to do it. God did it. Yeah, he went through it. He knew that under the law, sin was death. And the only way to pay for that was through sacrifice. He put his son, on that altar to pay with his blood for us. So you can't just stop with praising and thanking Jesus. You have to understand the whole scope of the thing that was done on that cross. That's why the ground split right there, because God, it was done, the law was followed, which is why we're in such perilous times right now, because people call this president the lawless one, the man of perdition. Well, that was spoken about a long time ago.
I agree. And one thing I would say in this is, from all the dark and different ways that we have heard that the United States is going to turn into, you could almost bet that there might be a few things, many things, or none at all. We truly don't know, because there is, you know, the potential of there being an event. You can only, as they say in war, plans are only as good until the first shot is fired. You know, if you really think about it, the West right now is trying to control the new financial paradigm. You've heard people like Jim Rickards, who think that we're going to have the IMF to use the SDR to replace the dollar. Well, honestly, I think that is beyond, that's a no. The U.S. is just reaching to try to keep hold of, as I like to say, they're no longer able to cut the mustard, so they're still trying to lick the jar.
Right.
But also, does it necessarily mean that Russia and China and the BRICS are going to control the next financial system? Well, guess what? There's a third alternative. Last time I checked in the Book of Revelation, there's a singular system, and it's run by no man. It's run by an entity. So when we see all these things, FEMA camps or EMP or nukes or plagues or this and that, there may be some of that, there may be a lot of it, or there may be none of it. We really don't know, and this is, I think, why we've got to, like I said to the previous caller, don't focus on the fears. What comes, comes. You can't control it.
Oh,
that's the most important
absolutely.
Thing is you can't control it. But what we can focus on is the relationship and focus on growing in trust so that when we are faced ourselves with a particular crisis or situation, that we know that we have the authority in the thing. Boom, I can get out of this because of him, his power, and I'm not worried about it. And then move on from there.
Amen. One, before I hang up, and this is unusual, but all the stuff that goes on about climate change and everything, people need to start, there's a on YouTube, his name is Suspicious Observer, it's Ben Davidson, the best in climate and physics you're going to see watching the sun. I mean, it will really bring people up to speed as far as how we're all being lied to, and these things are going off not only here but all over the solar system. And we need to become more aware and intelligent so that when people hit us with climate change theory lies, we're armed.
It's amazing. Climate change, we used to call it weather until Al Gore got hold of it.
A cold winter is now, we're all going to die.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Colin.
Yeah. And Sheila and Ken, I've got a listener out of Kansas City, Kansas, wants your take on what the scripted outcome is expected for the current scenario with respect to Ukraine. In other words, what the globalists see. For example, what Russia sees, and in particular, he wants to know about Merkel's posturing, what Germany is going to attempt to do, and what the globalists will be doing with respect to the final outcome. And again, I'm paraphrasing the email. I have not gotten a one sentence question here. They're paragraphs, but. But what the scripted outcome is for Ukraine at the end of all of this. So you can handle
that.
Have, right.
I would have to say it from the globalist side of the point. They don't care about the outcome. They just want chaos. Okay. Whenever we see anything going on, there's no real outcome. It's just chaos. From the Russian point of view, they want a solidified border. They want, the thing about it is Russia has been staying on the outside and not bringing in troops and allowing the Russian separatists within the Ukraine to either solidify the eastern half, which is on their border and would automatically become a buffer zone, or by attrition, they want to bleed the U.S. and NATO to the point that they no longer want to be involved in this. And when that happens, then the Ukrainian government's going to come over to Russia and begging them, okay, you know what? We were wrong. We need your help. Can you come in? And Russia's going to pretty much take over their governmental control. They really don't want to control the country. This is not the Soviet model, but they do want to control the economic future of Ukraine. They really don't care about the social, the societal, et cetera, et cetera. For the U.S., the Ukraine represents the last stronghold of their empire against, you know, the Ukraine is this. It's the Wolfowitz Doctrine in play.
Wow.
They have the U.S. has to do anything and everything to ensure that no superpower ever grows again. And the BRICS coalition, led by Russia and China of the five nations, would become instant superpowers if they were to become the heads of the next global financial system. And the Wolfowitz Doctrine, which is pretty much run by, you know, the Cold War clowns, I like to call them, the living in the 70s and 80s, generals who were in the Pentagon, this is what they're running on. And so they're using proxy wars. Syria's proxy war. Ukraine is a proxy war. They don't want to get their hands dirty. They got to do the next Vietnam, the Greece versus Turkey, the whole nine yards of the old Cold War. Well, Russia's not going to stand by. Russia will just let the place go to pot and then walk in after the rubble's done. You know, plus the fact that Russia will sit here and go like this. You want to put sanctions on us? Hey, Germany, you know that oil and natural gas we're sending you? I hope you have something else in mind for winter because you're about to freeze. And suddenly, the Eurozone's going to sit there and go, wait a second. The U.S. did this to us, not Russia. The U.S. did. And they're going to come over to Russia's camp. This is what they're doing. Russia's offering economic freedom. The U.S. is offering military, you know, draconian methods. Russia is almost like off. This is how it's happening. Russia is trying to get nations to voluntarily come to their side. The U.S. is using military and economic force to force nations to scare them to death.
Yeah, and let's not forget that BRICS Bank, Doug, will be one of the major multilateral development finance institutions in the world. I mean, when you talk about $100 billion crises lending fund, or I mean, it's a contingent reserve arrangement, but whose backers represent 45% of the world's population and roughly 20-something percent of the world's economy based on GDP, you know, that's pretty telling. You know, that total trade is staggering. It's nearly, I'd say it's close to 20% of the world's total. So, you know, and you think about China contributing the lion's share, well, I guess that would probably describe why it's going to be headquartered in Shanghai. But the point is, that's pretty significant, wouldn't you say, Ken?
Oh, it is. And, you know, I don't know for sure what the capital that is used for the BRICS Bank, this $100 billion, but I would almost bet it's treasuries. And wouldn't that be like a nice stick, knife wound into America? We're using your debt to create the financial system that's going to bring you down.
Yeah, we're using your debt against you. Isn't that ironic, actually? That is really interesting. That's essentially China is essentially leveraging our debt as you know. Explain that to people, Ken. That's really interesting.
Okay, I'll use a different example that I know for sure, because like I said, I don't know what the capital for the $100 billion is at first, but here's what China did, and V has already said this and backed it up once. China went into Chase Manhattan, I think. I think it was Chase Manhattan Bank, and they brought in $1 billion in treasuries. Now, you're thinking, well, why didn't they deposit cash? Well, treasuries are AAA-rated securities, so they're good as cash. And as a matter of fact, they're better than cash. Because what China ended up doing is they deposited $1 billion of U.S. treasuries in the bank, U.S. bank. On that capital and that AAA-rated collateral, they were able to borrow $5 billion of U.S. dollar currency. What'd they do with that? They took that $5 billion and they bought U.S. real estate. So they took our debt, leveraged it out five times, and then bought all this real estate. And last quarter, so far this year, 22% of all residential and commercial real estate that's been sold in the United States has been sold to Chinese interests. You want to talk about They say that there's a real estate recovery. Well, 22% of it's being bought by the Chinese for cash.
And isn't it, Sheila and Ken, doesn't V, hasn't he said, of course, that it's going to be our children that will be providing the slave labor, because a lot of this real estate, this property, is going to be, I mean, it's commercial stuff.
Well, Doug, think about back when there was the Bundy showdown, when it was, you know, the Clive and Bundy deal. I mean, think about where that land was. And, of course, good old, you know, this unscrupulous charlatan, this senator, I won't mention his name. I know people have just, I know I just ate, so I don't want to. But anyway, the economic zones, think about that. Those economic zones, I mean, this is below market value for the land, too, as Ken just so astutely pointed out. So when you have this, you know, these economic zones, the Chinese essentially, they want their, you know, they want to get paid, essentially. So what are they going to do? Well, they're going to barter for these economic zones, which there's quite a few of them. So they own all the energy. They own, you know, they already own our ports. They own essentially all of the real estate. But they also, surprisingly, they can go in boots on the ground and gobble up all those resources. That's the scary part of it. And if the Fed, let's just throw this out there, if the Chinese own the Fed and the Fed owns your mortgage because your bank lends you the money, does China then own your mortgage, your 401ks, et cetera, et cetera? That's a question to ask.
Well, I'm sure, because you know what? From what I heard, and I think, I can't remember if this was something V talked about, or maybe Jim Willey, or someone recently, but here's where it gets interesting. Going back to the whole J.P. Morgan, the London Whale, yada, 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 yada. What if I was to tell you that our income taxes were securitized?
Excuse me?
Our income taxes became a securitized collateralized asset, and when there was a failure on the part of the United States to pay its obligation,
then that
collateralized security known as our taxes defaulted to the Chinese. And that's why the United States government has had to borrow 40 to 100% of its budget with debt, because the taxes no longer go to them. Now, part of that is that why there's a rumor out that the Chinese took over the Fed, because the Fed is where we send our taxes to.
Yeah.
You know, it gets really convoluted, but you know, there's, what is it we've heard some places, I think like Rome or Greece or something like that, everything's for sale. You know, from your integrity to your property, to, you know, your sexuality, everything's for sale in the most corrupt places in the world. Well, if you think about it, everything is for sale because we are a United States corporation. We're not a country anymore, and we have Social Security numbers, which means that we are considered property, resources, and the land is collateral. So,
wow.
Well said. With that, we're going to take our top of the hour break. We're a little late. But we're going to take it now, and you're going to listen to News in 2 Minutes brought to you by Full Spectrum Survival. I want to thank them for all their efforts that they put into that, as it's a very informative part of the Hagmann and Hagmann Report. So we'll be right back, ladies and gentlemen, to our third and final hour of the Hagmann and Hagmann Report on this Monday, July 21st, 2014, with Ken Shorgen and Sheila Zielinski. I want to give a quick shout-out to Salvatore, who's listening in Australia, where it's just after 10 a.m. Hello to you and to the Keene family in Rustburg, Virginia. Ken, I got an interesting question here I'll lead off with this hour. It's from an emailer, a listener named Adam. He asks, in regards to the international situation, are we seeing countries jockeying for position in the New World Order scheme for a one world everything, or is the protected class going to stay protected and the countries not really matter as much as far as position?
It's a good question, because there's both the secular and the scriptural view. You know, if we look at it from a biblical side, as we get towards that one world government, that end time, you know, it talks about 10 different kings. It talks about the world being broken into 10 different zones, and countries are pretty much moot. From the globalist side, they don't see countries anymore. You know, we know of the multinational corporations that their allegiance is to no one international, and that's why they're trying to create that one financial system. But for the smaller countries, like, say, Saudi Arabia, oh, God, they are jockeying for whatever position they can get. And that's why you're seeing a lot of the smaller countries, 80 to 100 associates, joining in with the BRICS. We don't know all their names, but they are tired of U.S. hegemony over them, either militarily, economically, or with foreign policy. So they're looking for an alternative, and that's why a lot of them are flocking to the BRICS.
All right. Let's go back to the phones here. We have a lot of callers on hold. We're going to go to Montana, 406 area code. We're coming to you. You're live on the Hagmann and Hagmann Report. Area code 406. All right. We're going to put you back on hold. We're going to go to area code 919. Thanks for calling in. You're live with Ken and Sheila on the Hagmann and Hagmann Report.
Hi, Doug. Hi, Joe. Ken and Sheila.
Good evening.
Evening.
Teresa. Boy, is this nation on a fast track. I was doing something kind of interesting the other day when I got wind of this financial situation with the BRICS nations. Here's the fast track. We are living in a post-constitutional era, unfortunately. But here's just what went on in a few days. Okay, on Friday, July 11th this year, Havana, Cuba, Putin and Castro met at a military base. Okay, on July 13th, which was a Sunday, they met in Brazil. And Angela Merkel was there, the German chancellor. And it's real interesting how, you know, she was a former communist in East Germany. And she decided on Monday, July 14th, that she was going to step down as chancellor, which this is just something that's uncommon. And I think she's going to the League of Nations. I don't think she's going to NATO. But anyway, here's the real scary part of this whole thing. Okay, and one more of the thing. On July 15th, on Tuesday, the nations met, the BRIC nations met. That's going to be the end of the veto for them and the currency set. And, of course, you know, there's Russia, Brazil, India, South Africa, Turkey, Argentina, hundreds and stuff that are really, and, you know, their nation, their world headquarters is going to be in Shanghai, China. And a lot of things here that is not looking good. And then, you know, you're going into the parabase with Canada and the United States. And when you're looking at Germany, that's a real, it's going to be a real questionable scenario. Goes out with them. You know, they're real tired of us spying. And the chancellor has really expressed her displeasure in it. And so, you know, if they agree and go with Russia, you know, that's going to have so many implications, like you had talked about, You're looking at financial powers. You're looking at money. All this is tying in. It's just amazing how fast we're talking. Now, when Chancellor, when she made her announcement, this was just during the 15th through the 18th. So you're looking at from July the 11th to the 18th, all of these major decisions are coming down. And here was something that, you know, Ken, you had talked about France. There was something that, a key word that really just rebalanced. That was their key word in this, rebalance globally. I mean, when you hear that word rebalance, you're talking devaluation from 50 to 60% of our money. That means, okay, even 50%. My God, a dollar is going to take $2 to make a dollar. You know, we're going to be paying out the Yahoo for anything. And, you know, it's just a real strange scenario how these things are working. But, you know, we have to look at this and everything that has happened to us since 9/11, it's an alarm. It's the harbingers. We have been warned and warned and warned time over again. The first breach was in 9/11/01, and, you know, our nation was under attack. Okay, and then... we just have one thing after the other. Of course, 9/11, it destroyed the BRICS field. It's kind of strange. You see this magnificent tower representing our country, and it falls. All of this is warnings, even right down to when the sycamore was cut down in the churchyard. And you know, when Washington became president, really, in this country in 1789, when everything was established, government was set up, it was on the very corner where 9/11 happened. And the sycamore fell.
You're referring to what Jonathan Cahn put together in his book, The Harbinger. And I want to thank you for your call. Ken, if I could take one thing away from what the caller asked, is what would be the ramifications of the U.S. losing its status as the world reserve currency holder?
Well, we can go back to 1946, because before the United States took over the reserve currency role at Bretton Woods, London, Britain, held the reserve currency for a few hundred years. So the thing about it is it's not new that a reserve currency sovereign nation changes. The key thing is this, and this is why it's so unique and so different. As opposed to any time in history, we are currently in a time when every single country runs on a fiat currency. Nothing is backed by anything. You know, you can reset a currency if you have the gold or silver resources to start over. Right now, the United States doesn't. They sacrificed, just like London did, they sacrificed all of their gold and silver to keep this system going. Now, this is also why China and Russia believe, after watching Europe and the West for so many years, they said, you know what, we can't beat them economically, but we can facilitate the management of the next financial system if we go back to sound money. And that's why gold and silver is so important. It is the just measure. And isn't it ironic that the quote-unquote Christian nation has left just measures and the quote-unquote former communist nations have gone to just measures. That should tell you right there.
How's that all going to balance out, okay? And this is one of the questions I've got. For example, let's say the average, well, it wouldn't be the average. Let's say somebody's got 10, 15, 20,000, I don't know, of gold or silver in their physical possession. I don't even know if that's a realistic figure about me. We'll even go 25,000 or 50,000. In what's coming, in your view, will that gold and silver be used for trade, for barter, for something, or will it be used to pay off debt? Can it be used to be for debt payoff and reduction? And part of my question too, with whatever might be coming until the very end, is there a chance that there's going to be a gold-backed type of currency that would take over what is going to be in the absence?
It's a great question, and here's the truth of the matter is I don't have a crystal ball. Even V doesn't have a pure crystal ball. Jim Willie doesn't. We have projections of what things go from historical reference. If the world goes to a gold-backed currency, the United States is not going to be able to play in the international stage unless they have gold to back their currency. The thing with the United States, and I'm in agreement with both V and Jim Willie on this, is there's going to be two currencies, the same way that China does right now, the yuan and the renminbi. One is internal, one is external. The external is going to be gold-backed. The internal is going to be, as Willie says, the Scheiss dollar. Now that one's going to be devalued because you can't really devalue the gold-backed one because who's going to trade with your country if you've got a devalued currency? Nobody. They don't have to trade with the United States. And this is the key thing. The BRICS nations are setting up that they're going to have more than 50% of the population. They don't have to trade. Their fruit that they're going for is to attract Europe. They could care less about the United States. The United States is going to become a servitude nation. We're going to be following the decrees of the BRICS nations. With that being said, for the individual who has gold and silver, I don't know how it's going to work barter-wise because we have lost, so many even retailers have lost the understanding of what real money is in silver and gold, like our grandfathers did.
Right.
However, I do believe this. Since the United States got rid of so much of its gold and silver, it's going to be at a maximum premium. And they're going to have to find the resources, whether it's oil. See, I think this settlement note that's going to come out of China and the BRICS nations and the BRICS Bank, I don't think it's going to be completely tied to gold because there's a lot of countries that don't have any gold, but they have other resources. And you're going to be able to use your resources, whether it's oil, natural gas, et cetera, as collateral to back your trade notes. And with that being said, if the United States does need to get gold, then when you get your new republic currency, the one that's going to be given to the people internally, then you are going to be to the point of middle class because it's not going to be completely a small 1% elite and everybody dirt poor poverty. There are going to be people who have set themselves aside here to be able to enter into the new financial paradigm, middle class, upper middle class, low grade rich. But it's not going to be the huge middle class that we had before. It's going to be a smaller middle class. And those are going to be the people who have paid off their debts and who have found assets that are valuable in the new economic system, gold and silver, et cetera.
Interesting. Paper and very
asset?
Well said.
Forget it.
Yeah. Well, yeah. And I get a question. Anytime we have a show like this, and Sheila, I know you can attest to this. Well, what about my mining stocks? as if they're going to somehow survive, okay? You know, paper. Or am I wrong, Ken?
Oh, you're wrong, except maybe if it's foreign. But here's an interesting thing. One time my parents were asking me to ask the Holy Spirit, you know, what should we invest in? And I was going through and I was asking the Holy Spirit, you know, the question this, and I kept getting no, 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 no. And after about an hour and a half, I finally asked the right question and got a yes. Now, we didn't go ahead and go through it, but if you think about it, it does walk both sides of the physical and paper model. And the answer was invest in mining rights in Canada. Because people who own property in Canada do not have fee simple. They only own the surface land. You can get mining rights from the crown, and you can go on somebody's property and mine it as you see fit. And see, that's a paper control, but you have control of the physical assets. Interesting concept.
Wow. That is interesting. I didn't know that. I have a question here from Wanda, who wants to know, well, if, for example, if the China comes out on top, or we'll stop right there. If China comes out on top in terms of the world currency, wouldn't it be beneficial if she had, and this is, I'm kind of changing her question a little bit, if she had in her home safe a whole bunch of Chinese dollars or yuan as opposed to Federal Reserve notes? That's kind of an interesting question.
Well, we don't know if the Chinese win out and they do eventually do a gold-backed currency. There's no real belief that it's going to be the same currency they use now.
True.
Might be something completely different. So it's like betting on the Iraqi dinar. Well, 10 years after the fact, not too many people are profiting from buying all those Iraqi dinar.
Yeah, I remember that well. Sheila, this is a question directed at you. I believe this is from Kevin. Thanks, Kevin. Actually for both. This is to the panel. If they're doing all of this, meaning the globalists, if the globalists are doing all of this deceiving out in the open, what does the panel think the great deception will be? Interesting question. I'll toss it to Sheila first.
Well, one of the things, when we talk about the great deception, of course, that is a spiritual connotation, and it's something that in the scripture God actually pours out on, you know, the people that are obviously not under his blanket of protection. So I think, I mean, that's a really loaded question. I mean, isn't that the $100 million question? We don't have a lot of indication from Scripture, but we do know one thing, that deception is going to be poured out in the last days. So, I mean, look what's happening in the church. You know, I've never seen, like I said before, I mean, you know, look what's going on in the church today. I've never seen a time where there's so much, I mean, absolute, not just prophecy unfolding, but, you know, look at Daniel. Go read the book of Daniel and look at what the scripture says in Revelation. I mean, we are seeing, that's the key piece, folks. We're seeing prophecy unfold. Like, what part of that do we not get? And no man knoweth the hour. So, you know, I think that's just the key point, is there's going to be a great deception that's, I think, already started. That's the frightening part of it. Because, Doug, I want to say, just to touch on what W said, you know, you're right, it was such a good show Saturday night, but I think here's the point. We need what Ken just touched on, and that is Holy Spirit discernment in these last days, because
Amen.
There are going to be deceptions, and many people, it says, the Bible says many people will be led astray. There will be many false prophets, many false reasonings. There'll be people who appear to be Christians in the last days leading people astray. So, I mean, there's never been a time we have to have more. We don't have all the answers, just like Ken said. We don't have some proverbial magic crystal ball, but we do have the Holy Spirit. And I'll tell you what, when you have the Holy Spirit, you don't really need anything else, do you?
Definitely not, Ken.
To give an example, I would say this is, and I'm looking up, the only place that it talks about great deception is it says that God will send out great deception, 2 Thessalonians. I wanted to verify this. So this is something that's coming from God specifically for a specific purpose. Now, if we look at what's all been going on from the most basic things in our society to the global things, the amount of deception going on is immense. And I'll give a great example. Since Israel became a nation in 1947, 1948, what is the most significant thing, paradigm, that sprung up in the church? Where millions of people now follow this new doctrine that was never before, but suddenly came up after 1947. The Messianic movement. The Messianic movement. The Messianic movement is based on living not according to the kingdom of God and the new covenant, but about living under the old covenant and the old rituals and the Old Testament with the belief in Messiah. Okay? It's a polluted, prostituted form, corrupted form that is not scriptural, not biblical, but because people have this deep need to follow rituals instead of walking simply in trust. You know, hey, put a backpack on, take your walking stick, and walk. No rituals, no compartmentalization, nothing, whatever. But this came from this sudden love and desire and worship of Israel. You know, I was looking up that scripture today where people say, you know, I will bless thee who blesses Israel. It doesn't say that. It was talking to Abraham. It was well before there was ever in Israel a land, a covenant, a law. He's talking about Abraham. Well, if you look at what Jesus said, love thy neighbor as you love yourself, if you do that, then you're accomplishing blessing Abraham and the people of Abraham. So sometimes we take things to extremes, and what has happened there has become this worship of things like Israel with a deception over our eyes that we ignore the unrighteousness. You know, the Jews that are righteous in Israel are easily superseded by the unrighteous Jews and the unrighteous government and the things that are going on there. We shouldn't just be blinded because we believe somebody taught us some scripture that, Israel is untouchable. And No, there was a reason why everything was exiled and cast out and burned aside. Because Jesus was like, hey, you know what? It's a new covenant. It's a new going forward. And if we have to put before us this, the law and going back to the old covenant is necessary versus what Jesus said of, I am the only way. There is no other way. Then we're all of a sudden we're walking in opposition, and, you know, that's enough to tear your spirit apart.
Okay.
It's really difficult because there's so many deceptions going on in this world. There's so much bad doctrine. There's so much, not only just in the church, but in society, in government, in the media. Sometimes we have to set it aside, focus on the basics, because otherwise, what do we believe?
Sheila, how do you feel about that?
Well, there's a lot. He nailed it. Ken just nailed the key piece, and that is that people are doctrinally retarded. And I know I'm going to catch heat for that, but it's just like many saying, you know, the Antichrist will make a peace treaty with Israel for 7 years. Well, the Antichrist does not make a peace treaty with Israel, but it confirms a peace treaty. Like, you know, you have to actually read the scripture, not just, you know, look up the ones before and after and build a doctrine on them. The point is that there is so much talk about Israel, but the point is, as Ken just alluded to, Jesus Christ almost himself superseded that. It, you know, you got to remember the Old Testament is a foreshadowing of the New Testament. And what is, you know, what does Christ say in the New Testament? Yes, there's commandments then, and there's a reason that we're pointing to Levitical law. There's a reason for the overshadowings of those kind of things. But, you know, what did he say? He superseded it when he said that, you know, the, as Ken just said, I mean, there's such an absolute mind-numbing, I know I use that word a lot, but I don't know what else to use when it comes to people being doctrinally dumbed down. There's a Steve Quayle word for you.
hey, Doug, I hate to say it, but it was your show that started me on a path of massive controversy. I'm blaming you in a good way. One of your guests one time was on Ricky Ray.
Okay.
And he was telling the story after the exile. And then I was reminded, I don't know if you had Jonathan Kahn on, but I do know his book, where the one thing that specifically said was Israel was destroyed by God, they were exiled, they were cut off from the root, which is in 2 Kings, cut off the root forever, and they tried to rebuild, and he said no. Well, what I did was the Spirit, when I heard those things, I was disturbed. I'm like, wait a second, I have all these beliefs. Now you've got these people telling me this and this. So I started doing some research, and I started going to the Spirit. And I started in Revelation. I'm like, okay, we're in the end times. We're looking at all these things. So thank God for computers. It's a great way to look through the Bible when you want to look for a lot of things and keywords. So I looked in Book of Revelation. I put in the keyword Israel. You know how many times Israel shows up in Revelation?
Zero.
Zero. You know how many times Jerusalem shows up in the Revelation? Zero.
Yeah.
It talks about spiritual Jerusalem. And if you look in the Greek, it's actually talking about the heavenly Jerusalem. I also looked how many times temple. Every time the temple was up, it was talking about in God's temple, yada, yada, yada. I looked at all these things, and they don't show up at all in Revelation. So I'm, like, disturbed. I'm like, okay, you got these prophecies in the Old Testament. You've got Revelation. They don't seem to jive completely. So then I decided to take all – I looked through, and I tried to find every verse that people claim justifies – the return of Israel in the 21st century or before, you know, from Isaiah to Hosea to Ezekiel to all of those. You know, I found something really fascinating. It does talk about a return, but in every single instance, it talks about a return when the root of Jesse, when David the king returns. It talks about the messianic. It doesn't talk about before.
Yeah, are you referring to the lineage or the
timing. I think you're talking about a return when, you know, the second coming.
Bingo.
Exactly.
Okay. Everything All refers right. to messianic. Now, like I said, I'm not trying to dissuade or change this doctrine, but I went to the very scripture, and I went back, and I stopped looking at modern theologians and what they believe. Because if you think about it, nobody really was predicting the return of Israel before 1947. Even rabbis who were in Germany at that time, they called it Palestine. They assumed it was Palestine. So I went back even before and back to the ancient. And the ancient rabbis were referring to these verses that we now today call to justify Israel. They were referring to those as messianic times, the return of or the coming of Messiah. So with that being said, is the return, because we know that the Zionist movement was created by Rothschild. He sent the first Kaolod in there. Is there a potential? And I'm just throwing it out. People can seek on their own. I'm not creating doctrine. Is there a potential that Israel, the purpose behind Israel, isn't necessarily God's purpose, but maybe for something for the adversary. And we are all focusing on Israel in these times instead of what Jesus said, look up, your redemption draws nigh. Look up, not out. That, to me, would be the one deception, because if the parable of the ten virgins is true, that five are going to be focused on him and five are going to be paying attention and dealing with the world, you know, when he comes, there's got to be some justification for that.
Very interesting, and I would urge people to really consider what Ken just said. Don't give a knee-jerk reaction here now. No, intellectually consider this. Sheila, your thoughts?
I think that Ken definitely has a good point there. There is so much talk, and there's a lot of preachers, let's face it, out there. Is it Kenneth Hagee that, or no, John Hagee, sorry, I'm getting all these fellers mixed up. But, I mean, look at the absolute virulent Chrislam even. I mean, he's talking about that now, mixing that in with, woe unto Israel. I mean, it's very bizarre what these people are doing. They're doctrinally mixing in a whole bunch of things, and I think Ken just nailed it, you know, draws nigh. Where are we supposed to be focusing on our salvation? You know, and the other scripture that I like is found in Psalm 50:15, and call upon me in the day of trouble, and I will deliver thee, and thou shalt glorify me. I mean, you know, if you call on Jesus, he'll answer. So whether we know doctrinally every little thing, I don't think that's the biggest piece, if we just have, you know, ultimate wisdom on every little piece, or if maybe we have something not quite right. I think the bottom line is, again, we have to have, Holy Spirit discernment, and we have to be calling upon God in the day of trouble. And we're in the day of trouble, Doug.
Yeah, we are. But Ken, let me bounce this off you here. Just so I'm correct, at least I want to be correct in understanding what you're saying. This kind of will lead to the ultimate discussion of the what we see taking place in Israel today, or in the Middle East, more appropriately, the Hamas attacks against Israel, and of course Israel taking out Hamas in Gaza, and the historical right for Israel's land, or for their right of this land. Now, history supports Israel's right to exist. We know that there's been an Israel up to the time, there was an Israel up to the time of the Roman Empire. The Romans conquered the land. Israel had no homeland, although the Jews were allowed to live there. They were driven from the land in two separate dispersions, one in 70 AD, the other in 135 AD. But there was always a Jewish presence in the land. So we're not talking about, I mean, we're talking about a Jewish presence here. So you're not necessarily negating that, are you?
Oh, no, not at all. And as a matter of fact, here's the interesting thing. And this is really the scripture that got me started. Okay. Going back to Isaiah 66:8, and that's a big one people use. Who has heard of such a thing? Who has seen such things? Shall the earth be made to bring forth in one day, or shall a nation be born at once? For as soon as Zion travailed, she brought forth her children. That's usually a big one that people use to justify the return God's hand in returning Israel in its present time. The fascinating thing when you look about it is, if you look at the word nation, the word nation is the word gawi. It means a people. The definitions are usually of non-Hebrew people, of descendants of Abraham, or descendants of Israel. It speaks nothing of a land, a kingdom, a country, a doctrine. We today in our language see nation as being the United States of America, Germany. We don't see nation as a people. And gawi is the root word of the word goyim, which we know separates the Jews and the Gentiles. So it's talking about a people.
Right.
Now, if we take this scripture and we use the word people instead of nation, can a people be born at once? Well, we already know that's true. When God made covenant with Abraham, he made him, I will be your God and you will be my people. He did that in a day. That's the reference it's talking about, the original Abrahamic covenant, okay. Not the creation of a nation. Once I started breaking those down and I went back to the ancient rabbinical commentators, that's exactly what they said too. So I started looking at this. The thing about it is being Jew is forever. It doesn't matter where you are. Because even before the Promised Land, the Hebrews and the descendants of Abraham were living all over the Middle East. Why was Israel, you know, and here's the thing too. Israel wasn't the original kingdom. The unified kingdom under Solomon was simply the unified kingdom with Jerusalem as the capital and Judah as the primary land. It wasn't until Solomon died and 10 tribes plus some Levites rejected following Solomon's son as their king, they split apart in rebellion and created the northern kingdom, a.k.a. Israel. And it was that northern kingdom that didn't last very long, and in 722 or whatever, 2 Kings, they were cut off and put into bondage, never to return. So, if God is in control in the creation of the land today, would he call it Israel?
Because very interesting.
He cut off. Hmm. Why wouldn't he call it Judah? Because that was the true kingdom. That was the true unified kingdom. Israel was created out of rebellion, and then they were cut off completely. He wouldn't really call it Israel. So whether it's prophesied or not, that's not my question. My question is it by God's hand? And if it's not by God's hand, then who, just like the original premise of tonight, who benefits the return of that land at this time? And we talk about the great deception. And look at what has happened to the Christian church. The creation of a new religious denomination, the Messianics, millions of people following, not focusing on the gospel, but going back to the old covenant and the law. We have so many people today who are focused on Israel and the things going on in Israel and the prophecy of Israel, but Israel doesn't show up in Revelation. So why aren't people focusing on their walk and their righteousness in the new covenant and in Messiah? It's the fruit I'm looking at that's creating these things. It's not worrying about doctrine or semantics or whatever. We ask that question, why is the church failing? Why are so many things wrong with the church today? Well, we're not going to find the answer by saying, well, read the Bible 1,000 times, because most people in the church have read the Bible 30, 40 times, but it hasn't changed them. So what underlying thing has really caused them to stray? You know, I wish I had the answer, but I'm seeking, because how can I talk with my brothers and sisters? You know, Paul said this, preaching the things of the cross to them that perish is foolishness. We tell these things to people over and over, but they don't seem to get it because they don't have any spiritual discernment. If they don't have the spiritual discernment, then we really don't know why they're doing the things that they're doing.
Interesting perspective. And folks, again, please consider this. Before you fire off emails to me or to Sheila or to Joe or to Ken, understand what Ken's saying here and understand what the intellectual discussion is, please. Ken and Sheila, as you well know, when we enter into a conversation that requires some review of what one considers to be, well, I don't want to say controversial, but we have to reevaluate our thought. It's always emotional and it's visceral at times. So think about what Ken's saying here. I mean, this is an intellectual discussion and it's got some merit, I think. And Pastor Langford, by the way, wrote a fantastic book, Revelation 13 Revealed. Folks, it's an extension. It's an extension of what Ken is talking about. So, and I think Sheila, you know, you've got that book or know about that book.
Yeah, well, and I think it's just important. One thing that Ken was saying, I mean, we don't really know, but what we do know is similar to what the psalmist says in Psalm 25:14. The secret of the Lord is with them that fear Him, and He will show them his covenant. So, you know, Ken mentioned that word covenant. Well, needless to say, every single true believer in the audience needs to be seeking the counsel of God for, you know, that Holy Ghost discernment, leadership within their own lives. Because if you read in Amos 3:7, it says, surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he will reveal his secret unto his servants, the prophets. So every single person, every child of God should search the scriptures for their own spiritual benefit, growth, and direction, I think, personally.
Yeah, and Doug and Joe, and I do apologize for pushing the boundaries of paradigm. I know, I just, you know, as we've talked tonight, a lot of the questions that do come up of how is Israel involved in this economic play? How is Israel involved in this? Israel's at war right now with Gaza. You know, those are important questions. But we also have to temper things and not go in blindly, assuming that everything that's going on in Israel is because God's hand is involved with it. It's, you know, and anything I've said, anything at all, go to the scripture, break it down. Most of the time when we quote scripture, we pick and choose verses that already fit our already established paradigm. That's the thing.
Oh yeah.
We don't go to a church to listen to a sermon because we already know what the scripture says. We go because we want to hear what somebody else's interpretation of it is. You know, that's why we already create the worldview. So instead, break down and go before the Lord and say, I've got this question. And if you don't have a question, then that's fine. Go before the Lord anyway. But I've got this question. Show me the truth of a matter. You know what? Frankly, I may be completely off my rocker in this, but I was led, and honestly, it was after listening to Ricky Ray and reading Jonathan Kahn when all of a sudden, wait a second, you know, God did these things with Israel, and I don't ever see, at least according to the covenant and promise, they weren't supposed to go back and land unless they repented. I don't know in 1948 what repentance did they do. It was actually done by fire and steel, you know. So I go back to the foundations of God and his righteousness, you know, read his covenants, the things like that. There may have been. I want somebody to know. I want somebody to disprove, because so far what I'm getting out of the book, not from other people's interpretations, I'm getting some really interesting opposition to what the belief out here is today. And as we get towards that time when we can no longer rely on the church, no longer rely on government, no longer rely on economy, it's just you and God. And we have to have our trust and our faith and our belief so solid that if we were left alone or with our families, whatever, then there's not a single thing we can't do by his authority and power to stave off whatever comes against us.
Very interesting perspective, Ken. And indeed. And, you know, this is something, too, we're going to pick up with Pastor Langford tomorrow, Steve Quayle, Pastor Langford tomorrow. Sheila, we got about 60 seconds, Ken. 60 seconds, Joe. 60 seconds. Sheila, I'm going to flip it to you.
Well, again, I just want to thank Ken for coming on. I want to thank everybody for actually phoning in, and especially the new listeners. And I'm really glad to hear that, you know, even if it's just 2 years or 2 weeks or 2 months, that people are waking up. I think there's a massive awakening occurring. And, you know, I my goodness, if there's any listeners right now that don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, that's the biggest thing I can say in the ends of these shows, Doug, is if you don't have Jesus, again, he's the ultimate prep, and if you don't have him, then, you know, it's really worth going to our website and, you know, clicking on those ministry tabs and seeing how you can make Jesus Christ the Lord of your life. And Ken, thank you for coming on, and I really appreciate that. I would like you to give out your website for people that would like to get into contact with you.
Thanks again, as always, Sheila and Doug and Joe. And probably the best thing to do is go to either thedailyeconomist.com, or the other place I write is secretsofthefed.com, and, of course, roguemoney.net.
Well, thank you so much, Ken and Sheila. We're up against the end of the show. And, Ken, we're glad to have you back on to if somebody or even anybody can biblically answer what you just put out there tonight. And we thank you for sharing that with us.
Great columns, by the way, Ken. Fantastic writing. Excellent. And Sheila, great research.
Thank you very much.
God bless you. All right. God bless.
Until tomorrow with Steve Quayle and Pastor Langford. Thank you, Sheila. Thank you, Ken, for a great night. We'll see you guys back here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Have a great night.